Sir, I am doing that Facebook sharing.
Chandra Dashaka sir, good evening sir. This is Dr. S.V. Achyut Rao. Welcome to our campus, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, welcome, sir. I am Dr. Selvan speaking, sir.
Hello, Selvan.
Hello, sir. How are you, sir?
Very good, sir.
Fine, sir. I am also fine, sir. Welcome, sir.
Sure. Thank you, sir. The program starts at 4:45, right? Or 5 o'clock?
5 o'clock only, sir. IT history, sir.
Sir.
Sir asking some questions. Program starts by 5 o'clock only, sir. Today.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. What Raja sir has been sent, it is displayed, sir.
Okay, sir.
Welcome to 1 week online FTP program on big data tool. Which is sent by Raja sir.
Yes sir.
Selvan sir, I am sharing screen, just to check it whether it is visible or not. Yeah, is
yes,
it visible?
Sir. Welcome to Saint Martin Engineering College, Secunderabad, Telangana, India.
Yes sir.
Yes, sir.
I am closing sir.
Yes sir.
Sir, Telangana comma Telangana tarvata pettandi sir.
Yes sir, comma comma is there.
Yeah, for the sample purpose only sir.
Okay sir.
Yeah,
it's in the text part.
Yeah, just for sample, for our purpose only.
Okay.
Yeah. Coming to the actual our screen, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Srinivas Kumar, sir, resource person will be joined within 15 minutes, sir.
Okay.
Dr. Kale, sir.
Sir.
Yeah. Srinivas Kumar, sir, has put text to me. He will be joined within 15 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Excellent, sir. Shall we share a link to group?
Wait, sir. We will share.
Thank you.
Wait, it's some time. Few minutes.
Mm-hmm. Excellent, sir. Live started.
Going, sir.
Going. Post to the link, sir.
Wait.
In chat box.
Wait.
Raja, sir, two accounts you had?
Yes, sir. Laptop and mobile.
Oh, good. Safe side.
Yes, sir.
Sir, now it is live in WhatsApp, in that Facebook also.
Oh, Facebook, no?
Good evening to all. Please use this link for our live stream. I am posting in that chat box, sir.
Okay, okay. Same link can be posted, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Check it, sir. You have opened Facebook?
Yes, sir. You just click that link. No need to open your Facebook.
Yeah, yeah. I will be clicked.
Yes, sir. It's working.
Working, huh?
Yes, super.
That's all. Thank you, sir.
No one is on the screen. Yeah.
Sir, we can give the same link to our groups also.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I will share it.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Kalichalan, sir. Kalichalan. Do one thing. Kindly send this to my WhatsApp.
Message,
The Facebook link. Facebook link.
Sir, Babu sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening, man. Good evening, Chandra Garu.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Nice to see you.
Thank you, sir.
How is the internship going on?
Very good, Andy.
Very good, okay. Good initiative.
Good evening, Din sir, Babu sir.
Hi, Achit.
Good evening, welcome back. Within short time, we have seen today, one of time.
Yes. You see, we have been on this meeting since morning. I was worried at the particular, when required, our bandwidth should support. It should not say, no, I'm out. So, Inclanja, you are speaking from house only?
Yeah, Facebook is so nice. Raja sir, we will able to see Facebook clearly, very clarity.
Yes sir, Facebook is working.
Facebook, what is the link? Same link or different?
Different sir, it is posted in chat box.
Yeah, please look at our chat, sir. Babu, sir.
Yeah.
There you can find share. You can find that Facebook link.
Why are you putting in chat here?
We are testing now.
Okay. Put it in that, WhatsApp group. For those people who could not join, they... Raja.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Krishna, sir. Krishna Bazar, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Everything ready, sir?
Yes, sir. Last 2 days, we are only with this Zoom app only. We forgot our family, children, everything.
Going forward, our grandchildren,
sir.
Going forward, our grandchildren will have Zoom as part of their name.
Yes, sir. Sure. 100% true. Whatever is telling, that is true. Sir, Raja, sir, tell me, sir.
Can we share or we have to wait?
Wait, sir. That Zoom link you told, na? 1 minute. Sir, Raja sir, I shared the link with you in the WhatsApp, sir.
Okay, that is why I already copied.
Same.
I'm asking to participants.
Participants, sir, already we have shared with you now, sir. For when? Now time what, sir? 4:40. 4:45 sharply you post it, sir. Sir, what is your suggestion, sir? Achyut Rao, sir. Hello.
Sir, Dr. Raja, sir. Yeah, 20 minutes sir. Enough, sir. 20 minutes. You can share 4:40 to 4:45 like that time, sir.
No, sir. இப்ப நான் உங்களுக்கு மெயில் அனுப்பிச்சிருக்கேன் சார். மெயில் அனுப்பிச்சிருக்கேன். நீங்க மெயில் செக் பண்ணுங்க சார். நீங்க மெயில் அனுப்பிச்சா மெயில் அனுப்பிச்சிருக்கேன்.
ஓகே சார். ஓகே சார்.
இல்ல சார், நம்ம எல்லாரும் அதல தான் சார் இருக்கோம். நோ 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 பாஸ்வேர்ட். நோ பாஸ்வேர்ட்.
डॉक्टर राजा सर
गेम
डॉक्टर राजा सर
can you hear me
hello normal go
sir
yes no I am the desire
sir can you hear me
welcome sir dr srinivas sir welcome sir
okay ken sangathi hello mama em chestunnaru
good evening neha madam
very good evening sir
Dr. Srinivas Kumar sir, welcome sir. Dr. Kalai Selvan sir.
Sir.
Sir, Dr. Srinivas Kumar sir, resource person of
yes sir. Good evening,
DV Srinivas Kumar. Yeah.
Good evening sir. DV Srinivas Kumar sir. Good evening sir.
Palle. Mantending work chestunnadu.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Sir. Thank you, thank you.
As a co-host, sir, actually, we are co-host, sir, today.
Okay, okay, fine.
Good evening, sir.
Eva, वाले तो यार international दे मार task की चीज़ नो बटे मार ये publicity team है ना उड़ी create ये शी अंदर ना पेर बैठ गया लो सर मारे
करे सोर्स
लेकर अपने मम्मा लाइन
please mute that Srikanth Reddy and others
कावला नहीं
Srikanth Reddy only making this much of noise.
Yes, 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 yeah.
What?
Kalai Selvan sir. Kalai.
Tell me.
Enna start pannilama?
Ah, yes, sir. Start, sir.
Link sharing.
Sir, actually our respected
right
speaker also arrived, so that we can share.
Dr. Srinivas Kumar sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening, Achyut Rao sir. Good evening.
Yeah, sir. Very happy to see you.
Okay,
here. And we delighted to accept our invitation, sir. I am going to introduce our professors and our organizing members and coordinators, our CSI chapter, Dashika sir, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Let me introduce Dr. Amarendra Babu sir, Dean of Academics, sir. Amarendra Babu sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, yeah. Our FDP coordinator is Dr. Kalai Selvan sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Yes, good evening, sir.
Intro.
Professor CSC and coordinator.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Our professor, Dr. Raja, and one of the coordinators, FDP, sir.
Achha. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Raja,
good
sir,
evening.
Can you hear
good evening,
me?
Sir.
Yeah. Raja, sir, is
yes,
not
sir, hearing, sir. Good evening.
Our one of the well-wishers. Yes,
okay.
Sir. Our one of the well-wishers, who is CSI Charters, one of the good represented, toughest represented, or well-wisher, Dr. Chandra Dashaka, sir.
Good evening, sir. Good evening.
Always supporting us.
Oh, great.
Yes, sir. Sir is supporting since our college inception. He is a very well friend of our dean, sir.
Okay.
Dr. Babu, sir.
Yeah. I see, sir.
And also, we are very happy to introduce one of the persons who is a well-wisher of our St. Martin's Engineering College, both CS and IT departments, Secretary of CSA Chapter, Hyderabad, Dr. A.V. Krishna Prasad, sir, Professor CSE.
Okay, sir. Good evening, sir. Good evening. Good evening.
And one more member, Dr. M. Venkatrao, sir, will be joined with us, sir.
Okay, sir.
Who is Professor CSE, Controller of the Examination.
Okay.
And Neha Nandal is one of our activist, active participant. He is very good in all-round development. He is one of the important person of our organization. Neha
good
Nandal,
evening, sir.
Good evening, good evening, madam.
Next, I hand over to Dr. Kale Selvan, sir, coordinator. Sir,
okay.
Sir. Sir, good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, we are the co-host, sir.
Okay, sir.
We can able to unmute ourselves because I have muted everybody.
Okay, okay. Fine,
so
sir.
That the people who are given as a co-host, so they can mute by themselves, sir.
Okay, okay. Fine, sir. Fine.
Because
sir.
I am also doing here.
Okay.
So whenever we are making them as a co-host, I am making mute also. We can able to unmute, sir.
Fine, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So all the screen sharing facilities with you, sir. All the controls with you.
Okay. Let me just check the screen sharing once, sir.
Sure, sir.
Okay, sir. I want Facebook.
Yeah, Dr. Srinivas,
yeah.
Sir, you wanted to look
yeah.
over screen sharing and controls.
Yeah, yeah. Let me just share it once, sir.
Dr. Kalai, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Fine, sir.
Are we clear with the screen, sir?
Yes,
yes.
Yes.
Yeah, right. Right. Thank you.
Dr. Srinivas, sir.
Yeah, please, sir.
Actually, no, your microphone, if you keep it little away, it is better. Otherwise, you're getting muffled sound.
Okay, okay. How is it now, sir?
Now very clear. Yeah.
Fine. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Maybe it is low. The volume is low now.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Volume is low.
I'll just adjust it.
Just bring it slightly near, sir, that microphone.
Okay, fine, sir. I will do that. Okay, how is it now, sir?
Yeah, better.
Okay.
Okay. Can you see the screen, sir? Sir?
Yeah, I can see the screen, sir.
Yeah, actually, once you are bringing near to your microphone, near to the near to your mouth, now it is giving muffled sound.
How is it now, sir? Is it okay, the position, or should I make any changes?
A little away from you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, though the voice is a little low, but it is clear.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah. Oh, Srinivaskar, you are with the School of Management Studies, University of Hyderabad. Well, somebody is using annotations.
Yeah. Yeah, we have disabled it. I don't know. Still coming.
Hello, sir.
Somebody has to clear this, you know, continuously. Annotation not muted.
No, sir, annotation we didn't give any permission to anybody.
Annotation is not muted, huh?
No, no, sanitation we are not giving anywhere. But I don't know how.
I can't be able to
in that case, if somebody is writing, can clear it off immediately.
Clear this, sir. It is cleared.
Okay, can you see me now?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You can see my face? Can you see my face?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's visible,
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, welcome, sir. Please, HOD, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Kumar, sir. And also our today's speaker, sir, also is there, Dr. Venkata Srinivas Kumar, sir, also is there, sir. Sir, Dr. Venkata Srinivas, sir.
Police, sir. Yeah.
Sir, maybe the end of session, maybe the queries is there.
Yeah.
So at what time we can plan for the query session, sir? Because 5 to 7, this is the timing.
Okay.
So what time last?
We can give hour? Last half an hour, sir.
Last half an hour.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. Good.
Because I want to ask the comfortability of our sir also. So according to
yes,
that.
Sir. Yeah, half an hour is fine with me. Fine. But do we get enough questions for half an hour? Because 1,000 participants are there.
Yes,
half an hour should be fine.
Fine, sir. We'll
yeah, leave. Sir. Who are the participants are raised their hands. Accordingly, we will give, sir. If it is a repeated question, we do not give a chance.
Fine, absolutely fine, sir.
Dr. Kalai, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, some instructions will be... ma'am.
Hello?
Yeah, Nehanandal ma'am shall give that instructions.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Madam, you please check your WhatsApp, madam. The one message I am sending you.
Yes,
you just
sir.
Read out that message.
Okay, sir.
This is the information to our participants.
Okay, okay. Okay, before starting, I will instruct them, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Fine. Three not five members so far joined, sir.
Okay.
Sir, Dr. Venkata Srinivas, sir, can we start it by sharply 5 o'clock, sir?
Absolutely, no problem.
Okay, fine, sir. Just 5 minutes more. That's what then we can start.
Yes, sir.
And whenever I'm telling you, just give the instruction, then you can start your.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Dr. Raja, sir.
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 Sir, make me a sir co-host for both you, sir.
What, sir?
Kalichalan, sir.
Tell me, sir.
Sir, I am using two account.
Okay.
Make me as two as a co-host.
Right. Given.
But one was one. Yes. Okay, sir. Fine.
Given. Fine.
Raja, sir.
Sir.
Facebook is also nice, sir. It's live is going on.
Yes, sir. Facebook okay,
sir.
Is going.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Where is the Facebook link?
Sir, you check your what? Actually, we have put it in the chat box.
Our chat box, sir.
You can. Provide another DP also, sir. Three groups, four groups are there now.
Yeah, I said, sir.
Yeah, I forwarded to Raja, sir, as well as our friend Kale, sir. Yeah, I provided that link to you.
1 minute, sir. That Lakshman, sir, calling.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Sir, we shared simultaneously.
Hello.
Okay,
tell me, sir. Yeah. Whatever the information you send me, that only I can see.
I can see the Facebook.
Is there any password in that equally we can able to post that one? From the inside Facebook, okay, it is registering this number. Inside the Facebook is not possible, sir. This live streaming, sir. User ID password. Wait, 2 minutes we can start, sir.
Yeah, perfect.
Madam Nehanadal, madam.
Yes, madam. Yes, sir.
We may remove this sharing later on when it is handed over to sir, then he can share it. Srinivas, sir.
Yeah, tell me, sir.
Can you take out the share so that all are visible?
Yeah, fine.
When the screen is handed over to you, then you can share.
Definitely, no issues. I'll just.
Except for the speaker, everybody should be on mute. If somebody is making noise, mute them, except for the speaker can do it.
There are only co-hosts are in that unmute, sir. Other people are in mute only. Okay. So total 440 participants so far, sir.
Yes, sir.
Chandra Dasaka, sir.
Yeah, he was joined. Yeah, he joined.
I'm muting myself.
Sir. Fine, sir. I thought that you can't able to unmute like that. That's why I'm unmuting you, sir. Sorry.
No.
Sir, Krishna Prasad, sir.
Hello, sir.
Sir, fine, sir. You also co-host, sir. I given a co-host to you.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, sir, can we start, sir?
Yeah.
Now, for exactly 5 o'clock.
Yes, sir.
Okay, madam, go ahead.
Okay, sir. Before starting, very good evening to you all. And to all the participants, there are some instructions that I advise you all to follow. So, please listen to it carefully. So that we can go with the FDP in a smooth manner and efficient manner. The first one is, before starting the session, please mute your audio and video. And please don't scribble anything on the screen during the session, as it is causing inconvenience to the speaker and other participants also. Utilize your chat box for asking any questions, if you have any questions in between. And hopefully the participants are joining now, continuously joining is going on, and it was advisable to join before 10 minutes for the smooth going on of the session. And last one, very important one, please be active in the WhatsApp groups. Already you all are added in that. Please be active in that group and continuously check it for the further updates. So these are some instructions that I wanted to share with you all. So please follow them and it will be useful for all of us. Thank you so much for listening to these instructions. And now we will start with our FDP program. So greetings of the evening again. I am Neha Nandal, working as assistant professor in St. Martin's Engineering College. And I thank to each and every one of you for being here with us today. And we are getting a huge response from all of you. And it is very appreciable to all of us. And we are overwhelmed because of this response. On behalf of St. Martin's Engineering College, the management, our chairman, sir, Shri Mari Lakshman Reddy, executive director, sir, Shri G. Chandrasekhar Yadav, and our young, talented, and dynamic principal, Dr. P. Santosh Kumar Patra, Computer Society of India, Hyderabad chapter, all deans, HODs, of Department of Computer Science and Information Technology and all other departments of institution. I welcome you all in the Faculty Development Program on Big Data Tools organized in association with Computer Society of India, Hyderabad chapter. St. Martin's Engineering College is an autonomous institute, an NBA and NAC A+ accredited, approved by AICTE and affiliated to JNTUH. It was established in 2002 and it is located at Dullapalli, Secunderabad, promoted and managed under St. Martin's Children's Education Society. In a very short span of duration, at very young age of the college, several achievements have been done by the college. And this FDP program, with the support of our management and our authorities, we are able to make it organized, and we are very thankful to all the support that we get from our management side and all the deans, HODs, and especially the Computer Society of India, Hyderabad chapter. This FDP, Faculty Development Program, aims at providing a forum for members of the research and academic community to interact on cutting edge and groundbreaking topics in big data analytics. So in this faculty development program, we have profound speakers available with whom we will interact every day in the sessions, which are like Dr. D. Venkat Srinivas Kumar from University of Hyderabad, who is also the speaker of the day, Dr. Sunil, Director, Data Science Lab, Ericsson, Dr. Suresh, data scientist from Tech Systems, Mr. Sai Pavan, big data developer from Nimitri, Mr. Prasad, big data developer from Solix Technologies, and Mr. Srinivas, big data expert. So it becomes a platform where we get a huge exposure towards big data tools. Now, moving further, let me introduce the head of the department, Computer Science and Engineering, of St. Martin's Engineering College and also the convener of FDP, Dr. P. Uday Kumar. He is having 27 years of experience in both industry and teaching. His area of research includes networking.
No.
Yes, you cut it.
Yes. Sorry for the disturbance in between. The HOD's area of research includes networking, wireless sensors, and cloud computing. Professor has published 50 plus research papers in different national and international journals, along with 5 patents and 2 books. He is recipient of Best Inventor Award in 2019. And if I tell you, he is a pillar of the department, being a part of Computer Science and Engineering Department of SMEC, I can tell you that. So I request Dr. P. Uday Kumar to talk about the program and interact with us all. Sir?
Thank you, madam. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good evening to you all. I thank this opportunity. I really am very happy to share some important points about this big data tools, the FDP program. And actually, this is a 1-week program organized in association with the Computer Society of India. First of all, I welcome our young and dynamic principal, Dr. Santosh Kumar Patra, motivated us from the beginning. And because of his inspirational guidance, and the registration reached the maximum level 1,000. I welcome all the honorable speakers, especially Dr. Venkata Srinivas Kumar. He is the speaker today. And other speakers, I would like to say, Mr. Sai Pavan, Mr. Prasad, Mr. Srinivas, Mr. Sunil, and Dr. Suresh. So I want to mention these things there mainly. All are experts in big data tools. I welcome Professor Chandra Dasaka, Vice Chairman, CSI, Hyderabad Chapter, Mr. Krishna Prasad. I welcome Dr. Achyuta Rao, HOD IT. I welcome Dr. Amendra Babu, Dean Academic. And Dr. Venkat Rao, he is the backbone of this program. And the coordinators, Dr. Kalai Selvan, Dr. Raja, all the committee members, faculties, and participants from all over India. It is my pleasure to share some few words about my department. The department commenced right from the inception of this college in 2002, and the intake is 240. All the seats are full. We have tie up with various multinational companies which offer training in latest technologies, placements, and internships. We have highly qualified and experienced faculty members who have authored 24 books and published 57 patents, and most of the research papers were published in Springer, IEEE, Scopus indexed journals. Our placement is about 88%, and remaining also in higher studies and started their own company. That means almost 100%. Recently, our two students are placed with 31 lakh package in Amazon Group. That is the very great achievement. And we are the first one to organize online international conference on 18th, 19th June 2020. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much, sir, for your motivational words. And also about the computer science department of St. Martin's Engineering College. And it has been a continuous journey that of the progress. And obviously being with you, working with you, it's a great pleasure for all of us, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Now, moving forward, I am introducing the HOD of Information Technology IT Department of St. Martin's Engineering College, and also again the convener of FDP, Dr. S.V. Achyut Rao. He is lifetime member of ISTE and CSI Society. He is having 70 research papers in different national and international journals, along with 7 patents, 3 best awarded papers. His research area includes machine learning, deep learning, big data, and data science. Now, I request Dr. Achyut Rao to say a few words about the program and enlighten us about the key points about this big data tools. Sir?
Yeah. Good evening, Nahanandal ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah. Good evening, sir.
Yeah. Welcome to St. Martin's Engineering College. I am very delighted to see such a 1,000 participants and their response. I am happy to say a few words about our institute, department, and about Big Data Tools program. I very much thankful to our management and principal, sir, for this backbone of entire program and motivation given by Dr. Amarendra Babu, sir, Venkat Rao, sir, Kalei Selvan, sir, Raja, sir, and program organizing committee and e-publicity team, all the members, Dr. Raja, sir, and Pratima, madam, Krishna, sir, Prashanti, madam, Chandrasekhar Reddy, and all the team members, and each and every person behind this program. I thank to each and every one, and especially I thank each and every participant who are enthusiastically know about the big data tools. Why? Because big data provides some astonishing benefits to all kinds of business across the globe, from education sector to health core industry. Almost each industry is now locked to the big data analytics somehow or other way. That's why we from St. Martin's Engineering College brainstormed together and planned to organize one wonderful online FDP program. Yeah, the prime responsibility of the teachers to disseminate a knowledge which will be an emerging technology to our students. Why? Because all industry is looking about R programming, Python programming, Hive, OG, Fluff, like that. Advanced technologies is a part of our big data tools and data science. In that way, we brainstormed together and organized a committee. Dr. Kalei Selvan sir and Raja sir coordinated with the help of M. Venkat Rao sir, Amarendra Babu sir, all HODs and my dear faculty members of CSE departments and IT department, we are organized. We thank to our resource persons who are in a busy schedule. They are in a industry expertises people. They accepted our involvement to give you a knowledge. And we thank to our CSA Vice President Chandra Dashaka sir and AVN Krishna Prasad sir. Thank you very much, sirs. And comes to Information Technology Department, which is started 2007 with a 60 intake. As per AST norms, we had R&D dedicated laboratory. We are developed 5 R&D projects and 3 consultancy projects with the worth of 32 lakhs. We had 3 books have written, more than 200 papers have been published, and our faculty are very dynamic. Each and every had, every member is a very specialized to disseminate the knowledge. We had 5 important clubs. With those 5 important clubs, we are moving projects from lab to land. Those projects will be helpful to our society. I pretty well happy to say our St. Martin's Engineering College is very best in placements. As our friends, one of our friends, Dr. Uday Kumar, said that we are in, our 2 students have selected for Amazon 32 lakhs. We are the only 2 candidates are selected, none other than any college, I'm proud to say. And our placement track record is about 88%. Recently, we are got an MOU with UiPath. That is a MNC-based company, US-based company, 1,000 crore employees are there. From that company, 17 companies are coming to train our students in robot process automation. And moreover, one more achievement from our third year students, we have been tied up with Gensar Technologies. 120 students have been placed in third year one, first semester onwards. They are undergoing training. These are all a few achievements. I thank to each and every organizer and our management principals, everyone, especially organizing team and e-publicity team. I thank to all participants. Definitely, I am sure this FDP program will be given insights about big data tools, data science, and other technologies. So this is a high time to move big data. Thank you very much. Over to Rehanandal, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much, sir, for highlighting the importance of the FDP program and the involvement of such eminent professors in the program, which makes it more efficient. So thanks again, sir. Moving forward, now I would like to talk about Mr. Chandra S. Dashaka, the Vice Chairman of Computer Society of India, Hyderabad chapter. Sir is having enormous experience in information technology and other professional experience with Mobile DG Converse Private Limited, Triska Software Solutions Private Limited, Satyam Computers and Electronics Corporation India Limited as CEO. So he has been a part of organizing several workshops and conferences, and which makes him really a very valuable resource to us. And he has been always supportive to the St. Martin's Engineering College, and we are very thankful to him. I request Mr. Chandra S. Dashaka to interact with us all and say a few words about FTP.
Thank you, Neha. It is always sweet to hear nice about oneself. Thank you. I welcome all the participants. Yeah. I welcome all the participants to this 1-week program on behalf of Computer Society of India, Hyderabad chapter, and its special interest group on big data analytics. I sincerely appreciate St. Martin's College for conducting these FDPs. I appreciate their choice and selection of topics, ensuring the coverage of both the length and breadth for a comprehensive exposure and knowledge. St. Martin Engineering College and its leadership, kudos to you. You are putting untiring efforts in conducting these programs day after day and week after week. A lot to learn from you. Okay, I wish all the participants all the best. And I appeal to all of you to make the best use of this program. As you see the list of the speakers, the organizers have taken best care in choosing the best speakers for the program. I am sure the program will be remembered for its excellent quality. All the best to you all. Over to you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your words. And they are always valuable to us, and we really value you. And thanks again, sir. Next, I would like to talk about the principal of St. Martin's Engineering College, Dr. P. Santosh Kumar Patra, a recognized academician and educational administrator with the objective of producing the highest echelon of technocrats. Sir, the research area interest of principal, sir, is artificial intelligence, software engineering, data mining, warehousing, wireless networks. Professor is having several achievements on his name. He has been honored with Governor Award 2 times, Rashtriya Gaurav Award, Rashtriya Vikas Ratna Award, Dronacharya Award, and Young Leader, Young Inventor Award. During his career, he has received 79 lakhs fund from DST, MHRD, Government of India, consultancy projects with 200 crores from GHMC Hyderabad and 31 lakhs from UGC. He had facilitated 300 Akash tablets from IIT Bombay. So, sir has published 14 patents, 12 books, and more than 78 international and national research papers, 12 magazine articles, 138 newspaper coverages. He has been an active member of ISTE, CSI, IAENG, senior member of IACSIT Singapore, and SDIWC USA. So, he has been and he is a great, great pillar of the institution, and always being supportive to the staff, always being available for the queries. And recently he has been honored as an advisor to NAC Bangalore, UGC Paramarsh, National Cyber Safety and Security Standards, Government of India. He is on the editorial board of Teta McGraw-Hill, International Publication, High-Tech Publications, etc. And much more. It is very less to talk about him, about his achievements. And we are really fortunate to have him as our principal in St. Martin's Engineering College. Sorry for the interrupt in between. So, Principal Sir will be joining us soon. And so right now, I will be moving forward. And next, I will introduce the Dean Academics of College and advisory committee member of FDP, also the another pillar of computer science and engineering department, always available for everything, for all the helps required, Lieutenant Colonel and Dr. Amrinder Babu. The research interest of sir includes speech processing, machine learning, information security, and cryptography. He has been with the Indian Army for 23 years, and he has worked with research and development experience in the DLRL, DRDO of Project Samyukta, AVP at Mahindra Satyam, and GP Project Manager at BSIL for 12 years. So like he is one of the most valuable resource of our institute, and always his guidance makes us look forward to different visions of doing things. He has attended several national and international conferences along with publishing papers in numerous journals and also patents. Now I request Dr. Amrinder Babu to address the participants and give his valuable views about FDP. Sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the good words.
Thank you, sir.
Chandra Dasaka, sir, Vice Chairman, CSA, and Srinivas Kumar, sir, from EOH. They are our guests today, and thanks for joining us. And our HODs, Dr. Venkat Rao, our coordinator, Kalai Selvan, Dr. Raja, who has been interacting with you, and Neha Madam, who has been addressing you now, and so many participants. In fact, 1,000, I think they are to join. So many, I welcome you all, and the principal is slightly away on a meeting with AICTE, so therefore he asked me to address. So on behalf of the principal, of course he will be addressing you a little later, maybe tomorrow or day after or in one of these days. I'm happy that, you know, the CSC and IT departments have initiated this FDP and Big Data Analytics, and congratulate the team who has done a lot of work on this. Our college, and as you know, I will not talk much about, I will not stand between you and the resource person, but just take 1 or 2 minutes, 1 or 2 seconds only. We are, you know, NAC A+ accredited. And after that, UGC has made us the advisor to the other colleges by recognizing as UGC Paramarsh Mentor. This point I want to bring out. And then secondly, I want to say that our college has got 17 acres of land and big sports area where our chairman is a very keen sports person. So there is a lot of encouragement in our college for sports people, and also a lot of greenery. And of course, you know, by the way, people have told you that there is an organization called special interest group with data analytics, but this is a very good very big organization where, you know, Chandra Dasaka is the secretary of that. So he has been along with that for a long time. So you also will be interested because you're all, you know, going through these big data tools. So you will be interested in people who are working in that particular area. All experts in big data are the members of that. And also, of course, Krishna Prasad, who is the CSI secretary. I'm happy that, you know, 1,000 participants have come for participation. And on behalf of the management, principal, I welcome all of you again. Thank everybody for logging in. And I wish you a good health. I can see some people are with mask also now. And this big data is very much related to fight corona. So you, and also I request all of you to make full use of the time you have in these holidays, not holidays, during this corona lockout.
No.
Okay, thank you very much. Wish you all the best.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wishes and highlighting the importance of this FDP in this technical era. And now, moving further, I would like to invite Dr. Kalei Selvan, professor in CSE department of St. Martin's Engineering College, and also the program coordinator of faculty development program, to introduce the speaker of the day. So, sir, please.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Good evening to one and all. And I also, I'm inviting our Chandra Dasaka, sir, and our speaker, today's speaker, Dr. D. Venkata Srinivas, sir. Welcome, sir. We are waiting for your valuable class. So, sir, I'm just telling about the short information about our Dr. D. Venkata Srinivas Kumar, sir. He completed his PG from Andhra University in the Department of NBA Marketing Management and a PhD from University of Hyderabad in 2001-2006. And he having 20 plus of years of experience, and currently is working as a assistant professor and coordinator in the School of Management at the University of Hyderabad. Past 9 years of Hyderabad, and SAR specialties are CRM in manufacturing and services. And SAR going to handle today's topic is introduction to the big data. Sir, we are waiting for your valuable class. Waiting, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Kalei Selvan.
Thank you, sir.
At the outset, let me congratulate the team of St. Martin's, because when I have gone through the entire introductions that were given by the various leading personalities of the college, I could very clearly understand what it means by teamwork and the kind of results teamwork could produce. Because especially generating around 1,000 registrations for an online webinar is not a simple thing. That very clearly reflects, one is the kind of leadership the college has got, and second one is the kind of the team, which is very important in terms of making events very successful, right? And of course, I could also see here the representative of Computer Science, Computer Society of India, Mr. Dasaka, right? Chandra Dasaka is there. My regards to him also. So let me also thank you at the outset in terms of giving me an opportunity. I always take these kinds of meetings or webinars or any kind of conferences as an opportunity in terms of sharing the knowledge which we have. It is not like we are teaching something to someone else. Rather, maybe whatever we have in terms of our expertise or knowledge, we generally share it with others. These platforms really help in terms of better networking as well as sharing the expertise we have with us. Now, at the outset, let me answer a question. As you see, I am related to an MBA department. Then, where is the connect between big data as well as an MBA department? You see, things started changing after 2010, when we slowly noticed that most of the businesses, they started deploying analytics. Now, this raised more questions, this raised more doubts in terms of how the future is going to be as far as management education is concerned. There are lots of deliberations at the university level, because in 2017, when we actually launched the MBA in Business Analytics program, there were lots of doubts with respect to the first thing is the feasibility of the program. Second is related to the takers for the program. And the third one is related to whether this program eventually would be successful or not. Because is it just a some kind of a fad or some kind of a buzz? Or really, are we going to integrate business with that of analytics? Basically,
experience reveals that the kind of decision we had taken, was right, because most of the working professionals, they opted for this program because they have seen it as an opportunity to blend their expertise in software with that of business management and then lap up the opportunity that is in the area of analytics. Now, with this little bit of introduction, let me actually get into the area of today's what you call topic that is related to an introduction to the big data. Now, I have a very small presentation that is related to the big data. In fact, I would like to go ahead with respect to. With a discussion mode rather than going in a lecture format. So to start with the discussion that is related to big data, of course, today big data is the buzzword. Sometimes questions arise in terms of whether big data is really something that is happening or is it more of a hype that is created in the market. And we'll try to address these things. But before getting into the kind of questions that we have to address, let us first try to understand what exactly constitutes big data, right? So if you are trying to have a peep into what exactly is this big data, because as such we are dealing with the data. Now, in addition to the data, we also have something else called as big data. Then interestingly, the question here is related to how is big data different from the general perspective that is related to the data? Or we will also look at a few nagging questions that are related to big data. So let us address this issue. What makes the data big? That is a very fundamental question. The second issue is related to how big is big? What exactly are we talking about when we are addressing or when we are using the term called as big data? Now, to start with, there is no one-size-all-fits kind of a definition for big data. Now, what we are saying when we use the term called as big data is, maybe we are dealing with certain types of data sets that the conventional computing techniques cannot process. And repeating once again, if you are not looking at exactly putting a rigid definition to big data, we can understand big data as a huge data sets that normal or the conventional existing computing techniques cannot process. Now, what does it actually mean? Big data is the data whose scale, diversity, and complexity require maybe new architecture, the entire platforms on which this data has to be dealt with. It requires a new architecture. Maybe the techniques in terms of processing the data, maybe the kind of algorithms that are used to derive insight from the data, right? So we need entirely a different kind of a perspective and a different kind of an approach in terms of dealing with this big data so that we can basically extract knowledge or we can get or derive the insight from the data. Now, what you're seeing on your screen is basically a collection of multiple frames of pictures that are taken at the famous New York Times Square, one of the busiest centers. Just imagine the kind of exposure an average person has towards the data. In fact, today, we need not be in New York to get exposed to the data to which the citizens of New York get exposed also. Just for a contrast, the statement reads, the average person today processes more data in a single day than a person in the 1500s did in an entire lifetime. Now, this is mind-boggling. Maybe if you look at around 500 years back, what people used to consume or what people used to process in their entire lifetime, the volume of the data, that much amount of data right now we are processing in a single day. That basically, this statement basically reflects the kind of environment in which we are living. In fact, towards end of the discussion, we also look at some other interesting scenarios where the kind of scenarios that would be generated with the kind of information each one of us is generating. So we look at the changing paradigms as far as the generation as well as the consumption of the data is concerned. Now let us look at a few facts. In fact, I would like to say that since we are dealing with big data, let me call them as big facts about the big data. As of 2013, experts believed that 90% of the world's data was generated from 2011 to 2012. You can take it. Maybe 90% of the world's data at a particular year, when you analyze it, you find that it got generated in the past 2 years. In 2018, more than 2.5 quintillion. Quintillion is basically 1 followed by 18 zeros. Of course, we'll get into the bits and bytes a little bit later. So in 2018 alone, more than 2.5 quintillion bytes of data were created every day. The amount of data in the world was estimated to be 44 zettabytes at the dawn, at the starting of 2020. Now, Google handles a staggering 1.2 trillion, right? That's exactly where we are talking about. The 1,000 billion is a trillion, 1.2 trillion searches every day. Now, if you look at basically the facts that are related to the big data, what we can understand here is maybe we are living in a scenario, where we are overwhelmed by data. It is not just that each one of us is adding to the data or each one of us is consuming data, but rather we are engulfed in data. See, just it came to my mind yesterday, post the lockdown, the number of Zoom meetings that we are having, maybe if it is not exactly Zoom or some other platform also, if you can imagine the number of meetings that are occurring worldwide online, imagine the amount of data, that we are creating. How many of us are using the data for educational purposes? How many of us are using the data for maybe a corporate meetings? How many of us could be using the data maybe from the perspective of government officials, taking decisions, making plans and other things? Now, directly or indirectly, knowingly or unknowingly, all of us are further contributing to the scale of the data. This is quite interesting because it is not data is different, we are different. We are a part of the data, data is a part of us. Now, remember, a few years back, when we started acquiring or using smartphones, who thought that maybe 80% of our financial needs could be addressed with a single smartphone? Today, if I am going out, I need not check whether I put my wallet in my pocket or not, but I should be very sure that I am carrying my mobile phone. It is as good as I am carrying my entire bank account in my mobile phone also. I can make transactions that are there. Now, this change in lifestyles, the creation of the new technologies, and then the adoption of these technologies by all of us, they are actually driving the big data. Because big data, if you look at, it is not exactly going to be a different kind of a phenomenon which is different from us. We need not think that only some kind of scientific instruments or some kind of industries are generating big data. All of us are a part of the big data that is there. So it is quite interesting that whenever we are looking at the generation of the big data, you find interesting perspectives that are related to the big data, where we are all a part of the big data. It is not that big data is different and we are different, but all of us are part of the big data that is there. Now, just on a lighter side, when I look at imagining the volume of the data of bits and bytes, now all of us today, very, very conventionally, we carry gigabytes of data. If anyone is still using a pen drive, I was amazed, maybe 15 years back, when there was a pen drive that was having 512 MB. oh, I can carry my entire PhD project, right? What all the data I'm looking at, multiple versions of the data, 512 MB, we were amazed. But today, of course, what kind of data we are carrying, that's a different question. But then everyone is carrying gigabytes of data. So that's exactly where we look at, maybe roughly speaking, 1,000, if not technically correct, but roughly speaking, 1,000 megabytes is a gigabyte, right? For maybe the common people who are a part of this webinar, 1,000 megabytes is a gigabyte. In fact, initially when we are looking at a gigabyte, I was quite confused because we were having a CD-ROMs at that point of time where roughly a CD-ROM was carrying around maybe 600 MB of data. So two CD-ROMs used to carry one movie. So we used to think that, okay, roughly 1 GB of data is like 2 hours of a movie, 2 hours of a movie. So 1 GB of data is 2 hours of movie, some kind of an approximation, because you cannot really exactly count bits and bytes. So that's where we are talking about a GB. And then 1,000 GB takes us to a terabyte. And then your 1,000 terabytes, a petabyte, of course, it goes from petabytes to exabyte, then from exabyte to zettabyte. That's where earlier we are talking about the zettabytes at the dawn of 2020. What is the volume or the amount of the information that got created? And of course, finally, 1,000 zettabytes is a yottabyte. Don't ask me what comes after this because I really don't. Beyond this, I did not go. So I am stopping there at a yottabyte. And then, of course, if you want to further look in terms of looking at what is this zettabyte, right? A 10 to the power of 21 bytes equal to 1 zettabyte, or 1 billion terabyte forms a zettabyte. Looking at these figures, one can easily understand why the name big data is given. And one can also imagine the challenges involved in its storage as well as processing. Oh, this is an interesting perspective. One part of the story is in terms of looking at the enormity of the data that is there, fine, accepted, but at the same time, the enormity also creates challenges in terms of both the storage as well as processing of the data. Now, an interesting question here. Why should we process the big data? Of course, this raises lots of questions, but then everyone, whether it is a government organization, whether it is a public sector utility, like you can look at transportation sector, transportation utilities that are there, or whether it is an educational institution, or whether it is an NGO, whether it is a defense organization, whether it is a space organization, everyone is interested in terms of processing the big data in their respective domains so that they can extract value from this particular data. Of course, to make things even more clear in terms of the value of the big data, I would like to take a controversial example. I believe around 2 years back, all of you would have heard about a scandal around a company called Cambridge Analytica. Now, what Cambridge Analytica has done is it was able to basically collect almost up to 300 data points for each individual, especially Americans, on the Facebook, so that they were able to profile the candidate. And once the profiling of the candidates was done, they were able to generate the messages that could actually elicit responses in the way they wanted. Maybe you can call it as manipulation, you can call it as influencing, or you can put a very simple term called as advertising, maybe political advertising. But then what they have done is they very clearly looked at individual profiling, and based on the individual profiling, they were able to generate the content in such a manner, because it is not the same content for everyone, but rather the content was actually generated so that it could cater to the individual profile. They are looking at estimating the emotions of the people. They are looking at estimating the backgrounds of the people. They are looking at the social and economic class of the people. They are trying to understand the biases of the people. And based on this, they are generating the content in such a manner that when people get exposed to this particular content, they get the kind of reaction they expect. Because I know that if you are shown this kind of content, you may not be interested. But if I am showing you, or if I am giving you the message in this particular way, maybe that would elicit a particular kind of response from you, which I need. So maybe if I look at, of course, this creates a lot of controversy because it is related to the privacy of the individuals, whether individuals know how their profiles are being used. That's an interesting scenario. So if you basically look at the kind of scenario that is there, we are basically looking at this huge data. And then if you are able to really look at the processing of this data and generating value from this data, how can we enhance the performance of organizations? Remember, even though there are some bad examples of the deployment of big data, it doesn't always mean that big data is going to be used in a wrong way. Healthcare is a very great example, or healthcare is an industry where if you really look at the kind of data points that could be generated with respect to a patient in real time, if they are made accessible to the service provider, right? Maybe in this case, a doctor, maybe the right kind of intervention can be taken at the right moment, which otherwise may not be possible in the absence of these technologies. Dr. Ashutra, can I continue?
Yeah, proceed, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Sir, of course. Proceed, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. So now, I welcome all of you to the new world of the data. In fact, it all started when Harvard Business Review said that a data scientist is the sexiest job of the 21st century. In fact, 15 years back, there is no term called as data scientist. Or if the term had been there, probably no one knew also, right? So interestingly, we had statements like, data is the new oil. We need to find it, extract it, refine it, distribute it, and then monetize it. So that's an interesting scenario where we know so far there were wars that were fought to control the supply of the oil. So interestingly, as far as the 21st century is concerned, people who have access to, who can process the data, who can really benefit out or monetize this particular data, they are going to lead the world. This is quite interesting in terms of a paradigm shift that has occurred with the advent of the big data, right? The big data scenario that is here. Now, we said so far that, okay, big data is something really huge. At the same time, we said that big data might be complex in terms of processing. But then, for us, fortunately, scientists at IBM, they were able to give us some 4 V's, right? It's called as a 4 V's framework that would help us in terms of understanding the characteristics of the big data. Of course, this is again not a hard and fast kind of a definition that is there, but then when we are looking at the big data and the 4 V's that are there, it gives us a framework in terms of understanding the characteristics of the big data. So what they said is, the first thing is, as we right from the start of the discussion we are talking about, the size of the data, the huge, the sheer volume that is there. Now this makes it completely unmanageable as far as the conventional technologies that are related to data handling are concerned. Conventional technologies, what I mean to say is in terms of the databases and the data warehousing techniques, whatever are there, technologies that were developed, they are not really very good at handling the volume or the scale of the data that is there. That's exactly where we are talking about. Maybe we are generating 2.5 quintillion bytes of data every day, 40 zettabytes. Maybe you can really imagine the kind of scenario that could be there in terms of the huge volume of the data that is there. And of course, when you look at the second scenario that is related to the data, let us look at the variety of the data. So if you look at this particular data that is there, now when I'm talking about the variety, there is no one single format in which the data is made available. So we are looking at the data that could be there in the picture format, data that could be there in the video format, data that could be there in the audio format, data that could be there in some kind of a PDF format, whatever is there, there is no one single format in which the data is there. That's exactly where we talk about the variety of the data. And of course, the next V is related to the velocity of the data. Now, if you look at a stock exchange and look at the number of transactions that occur, imagine the number of hits the server might be getting. Or you can look at a scenario like a website like Amazon. So when we are shopping, imagine for the server, maybe across the country, the number of people
the number of landing pages, because somewhere you're looking at the streaming data. What is the first page? What is the second page? Which are the products that you have gone through? Then finally, whether you have purchased this project, whether you have purchased this product, and then whether you have actually paid it online or not. And again, based on your purchase history, they try to optimize the page for you and say that based on your history, these are the products that we would like to suggest for you. So if you look at it, the other part is related to the analysis of the streaming data that is there. And of course, added to all this, somewhere down the line, this data has got another property related to the veracity, where there is a huge question mark in terms of the trustworthiness of the data. Because if you look at most of the profiles that are there, because we are talking about social networking, or you can look at the kind of data that is available where you have to check for the authenticity of the data that is there, because if you're taking decisions on the basis of data, your decisions are going to be as good as the data that you're going to have. If your data is bad, okay, using bad data, even if you're employing the latest techniques that are available, using bad data, you can never really look at getting the kind of results that are desired, because essentially your data itself is under a scanner, because you don't know whether you're dealing with the correct information or not. It's quite interesting. So these are the four V's of the data. So if you again look at the scale or the volume that is there, there is a 44 times increase in the data from 2009 to 2020. In fact, whatever is shown here, that was an estimate that was made earlier, but today's scenario shows that we have crossed this also. It could be almost, it is not 35.2 zettabytes, but 2020 almost at the dawn, we are having around 40 zettabytes of data. So data volume is increasing exponentially. Of course, all of us know this, but then the problem is in terms of handling this data. Now today, companies, they say that maybe they have moved away from terabytes of data, they're talking about petabytes of data. They say that it is common for them in terms of dealing with petabytes of data, because that's the amount of data that they are dealing with. Of course, the nature of the data and then the different types of the data, what makes big data, we will see it in a few minutes, but this is exactly where we are dealing with the volume of the data. And then looking at the complexity that is there, as I have already told, it could be genome data, it could be data related to my social networking activity, it could be the data that is generated through a satellite, it could be generated through an airplane, we don't know, various formats, types, and structures of the data. All these constitute, again, the complexity, that is the variety of the data. Text, numerical data, images, audio, video sequences, time series, social media data, multidimensional arrays, static data, streaming data. A single application can be generating and collecting many types of data. In fact, quite interestingly, all of us use our smartphones. One of the interesting questions asked by one of the technology experts is, do you know what your smartphone is doing when you are not using it? Are you sure that your smartphone is not relaying the conversations that you are having when you are carrying your mobile phone in your pocket, even though you are not using your phone? Are you sure that your mobile phone is not actually doing something with respect to the kind of the conversation that you are having? Answer is very clearly, we don't know at this point of time what is going to happen. Just give me a minute.
Okay, how is the voice now, sir?
Srinivas Kumar, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, is it, sorry for interruption, sir. Yeah, please adjust your audio, sir. Yeah, so that everyone will get a clarity.
Far away from your mouth, sir. Then it will be very good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now it's okay, sir.
Now it's
okay? Is it okay?
Perfectly all right. Perfectly all right.
Okay, sir. Perfect. Now I will log this. I will log this. Right. Fine. So now the question is related to how do we deal with the complexity? Because
unless you extract knowledge from all these types of data, there is no way that you are going to extract value from the big data. And of course, I'm not making a distinction between a scalar and a vector. We are using both the terms called as speed as well as velocity, right? So when we look at the third V of the data, that is the velocity, data is being generated fast. It needs to be processed fast. So we are looking at online data analytics. In fact, we will also look a little bit later in terms of what is this real-time analytical processing. Can we basically look at processing the data as soon as we get it and then again relay it back? That's exactly related to the latency issues that are related to the data. So maybe if you are having a delay in terms of taking this decision, that might result in some types of missed opportunities. Some examples include, maybe we are looking at the electronic promotions based on your location. Now, this is a reality. Again, this is not different. If you look at your phone, your smartphone can get your location, and God knows who is actually recording this location. Because if you really look at the summary that gets generated sometimes after a month or 2 months, Google says, this is your timeline. These are the places that you have visited, right? Maybe interestingly, added to that, or purchase history, what are the likings, what are the dislikings, right? What kind of promotions, say, for example, you're moving in front of a store, can the store send you some kind of a promotion based on your earlier purchases? That's an interesting proposition. Earlier, as I told, healthcare monitoring, sensors monitoring your activities and the body, any abnormal measurements that might require immediate response from the service provider. This is made possible. Maybe when we are talking about the business scenario, whether business happens or not is a different question. But when we are talking about healthcare monitoring, it's a matter of life and death, because the right kind of intervention has to occur almost in real time. You should not lose much time before taking an intervention. That's exactly a question between life and death. That's exactly where we are talking about the velocity of the data. And of course, the biggest problem is related to the veracity of the data. So how far someone can actually depend on the data that is generated? This is exactly related to the veracity, the accuracy and trustworthiness of the data, right? Whether the data is complete or incomplete, whether the data is consistent, right? Whether the data can be relied upon, is it truthful or not? These are some of the issues that are there. So just to look at these four V's, we are talking about volume, variety, then we are talking about the veracity of the data, and of course, we are also looking at the velocity at which the data is coming. These are basically the four V's that are there: volume, variety, velocity, and veracity of the data. Of course, this is a beautiful way of representing the characteristics of the data from the perspective of data visualization, because you can see very clearly that data, maybe you can imagine at rest also, but still you are dealing with huge data. Of course, data in motion is where we are looking at the velocity. Of course, the variety of the data, you're not dealing with a single format kind of a data, you're dealing with multiple formats of data. And finally, uncertainty. Why uncertainty? Because of the data inconsistency, incompleteness, ambiguities, latency, deception, whatever is there, these lead to this. Now, an interesting question. Okay, these are all the characteristics of the data, but then the question is related to who is actually generating this data. Now, we need to basically look in terms of addressing this scenario related to who is actually generating this data. Now, if you look at the slide, you can find that social networking and media. So is there anyone who is not using WhatsApp these days? Of course, right? Facebook was there earlier. Twitter, LinkedIn, blogs, site comments. All of us as individual consumers, all of us as individual users of different types of maybe apps or different types of devices that are there, if you look at the right side, we are talking about the deployment of mobile devices. We make calls, we use text, we look at instant messaging, we look at location-based information. We look at generating activity within the applications. Now added to this, the general question that I ask is, maybe when was the last time I went to my bank? Because today I need not physically go to my bank. I have many applications. I can do many internet-based transactions that could give me the same utility that could be derived if I'm actually working, if I'm actually working with the bank directly. I need not go to the bank, but rather I can work through my computer. I can make use of the internet-based transactions. I can still generate the same kind of value that is there. Then let us look at the other part. Sometimes this is also known as the industrial Internet of Things, where we talk about the hardware that is getting connected with the internet, your IoT from the consumer perspectives, but then industrial Internet of Things, where maybe a plane that is moving from one place to another place has got multiple sensors. Maybe it will have multiple beacon interactions. Machinery that got chips embedded in it, which are going to record the key parameters with respect to the functioning of a machine and relate back to a server. Maybe the interesting case here is we can predict the breakdown of a machine even before the breakdown occurs because you got the key data with you. So if I look at the sources that are there, right from the social networking and the media sites, the mobile devices that we use, almost these devices are a part of our everyday life, the kind of internet transactions we have and the kind of network devices as well as sensors that are there, all of us are generating the data. I cannot say that I'm not a part of the data. Knowingly or unknowingly also, we're all a part of generating the data. One is from the consumer perspective. The second
sorry to disturb you, sir. Again, yeah. Why, sir, that microphone problem will be there? Please. just.
The voice now, sir?
Now it's okay. But No. You have to use that microphone, sir. Headset you have to use. But no, that microphone distance between your mouth and that piece microphone, please.
Okay. How is the voice now, sir? Can you hear me, sir? Hello.
I can hear you.
Hearing, sir.
Okay.
Again.
Fine, sir. Thank you. Okay. Now, just to continue with the discussion, you can just have a look at the slide where we are talking about the scientific instruments with the mobile devices, sensor technology. But then, what does this mean in terms of big data? Are we just simply repeating whatever we have said earlier? The issue here is, if you are looking at the big data analytics, the progress and innovation is no longer hindered by the ability to collect the data, but rather by the ability to manage, analyze, summarize, visualize, and discard knowledge from the collected data in a timely manner and in a scalable fashion. So these are some of the interesting issues which we are going to discuss a little bit later in terms of how do you analyze, summarize, visualize, and discard knowledge from the collected data. One is in a timely manner. Second one is in terms of the scalability issues that are there. Now, let us look at how we have arrived at the current scenario. So if you look at the increasing data variety as well as the complexity that is there, we know that the traditional ERP systems at one point of time were considered to be very huge. Maybe if you really look at somewhere around 20-25 years back, we are looking at the ERP systems that were generated to have a universal interface within the departments across the organizations. They were considered to be huge, but that is where we are dealing with the megabytes of the data. Then came the applications that are in the early 20th century related to the customer relationship management kind of a scenario where we are talking about the segmentation, of the markets, then looking at customization for the customers, CRM legacy systems came into the picture. And of course, the explosion of the web was there. We are talking about behavioral targeting. We are talking about search engine marketing. We are talking about web logs. We are talking about offer history. From there, when we actually start looking at the evolution of the big data, where we are looking at not only the user clickstream data, but then the sensors and the RFID devices, what is happening here is the first and foremost change that has happened here is related to what is known as user-generated content. At one point of time, all of us were only the consumers of data. But today, if you look at a lot of data, take, for example, YouTube. Who thought 15 years back that you could generate your own motion picture and then you put it on YouTube where you will get views? What was happening earlier was someone was making movies you are watching. Today you have the ability in terms of making your own movie and then posting it on a site like YouTube, user-generated content. You look at all the social media, lots of user-generated content is there. This is one major shift that has occurred when we are looking at the big data that is there. People started writing blogs. People started expressing opinions. Now this is exactly where sentiment analysis comes into the picture. Today we have technologies where, based on the sentiment analysis, you can predict whether a movie would be successful or not. You can predict whether a particular political campaign is going to be successful or not by deploying something as sentiment analysis. And of course, you have spatial and GPS coordinates. In fact, Google Maps, or for that reason, you can go with your iMaps or Apple Maps also, irrespective of the company. Today, your GPS coordinates are a part of the life. And then the demographics, the kind of population parameters or the characteristics that are there. Then your HD video, audio images, speech to text conversion. In fact, today, just you hold on the button in your search engine that converts your speech into text. And then your product and service logs, nothing to talk about SMS and MMS. They, by default, they have become very common. So if you look at, this is exactly where when we are looking at the kind of scenario that is there today, our big data is a resultant of the transactions, the interactions, as well as the observations that are there. Now, this is creating a huge opportunity. This is where we are saying that the model has also changed. As I told you earlier, in the previous scenarios, the old model is where few companies were generating data, all the others are consuming data. New model is where all of us are generating data and all of us are also consuming the data. This is exactly where you find the paradigm shift in terms of the old model versus the new model of the generation of the data. Now, what are the issues here? How can we harness the big data? How can you basically harness the big data?
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sorry for interruption. Dr. Srinivas Kumar, sir.
Yeah, yes, Chitra, sir.
Please, can you check your voice, sir? Yeah, some audience not visible, audible. Some disturbance is there in the voice. They said that not clear.
I'll just shut down the fan and try.
Yeah. Some external disturbance is there while you speak.
No, sir. Please use that headset. And keep that microphone, you please keep away a little bit from your mouth, sir. I think then it will be good.
Okay.
Now it is right. Perfectly.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, sir. A little bit louder, sir.
Is it okay now? Is it okay now?
Yeah, sir.
Okay, sir. Fine.
Is it okay now?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Fine, sir.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
So now the issues are related to how do we deal with the changed scenario? There are interesting questions here. If you look at from the technological perspective, when the operational databases were there, maybe it is enough that you are capable of performing online transaction processing. That's where we are talking about the OLTP. Then came the era of data warehousing, where you are talking about online analytical processing. That came as the second wave. Now the interesting question here is related to real-time analytical processing, where we need to basically deal with the big data architecture as well as the technology. So that's where the prominence or the importance of the big data architecture and technology comes, because no longer we are happy in terms of dealing with the historical data, nor we are just happy in terms of storing the data, but rather we are looking at a scenario where real-time analytical processing is needed so that companies can harness the big data. So here what is happening is, if you see from the analytic perspective, everyone is trying to extract data in order to basically extract value from it. First thing is, you will collect the data, and then you are going to basically look in terms of extraction of the value from the data. So what happens here, as and when the need arises, ad hoc querying and reporting, the data mining techniques, data mining especially the term that is used in terms of finding out patterns from the data, especially in the context of databases, that's the second scenario. Of course, using typically the structured data with your typical sources of the data, and then dealing with small to mid-sized data. This particular perspective is related to the business intelligence that is there, where you have business value, but at the same time, it is manageable. It is relatively medium, and the complexity is manageable. But whereas when you're talking about the advanced predictive analytics as well as data mining, where the complexity of your technologies as well as your operations are going to be high, but at the same time, you're trying to harness the higher business value, we are basically looking at the optimization and predictive analytics, where maybe I am looking at real-time information systems. I'm trying to deploy complex statistical analysis. Maybe I am dealing with the data from multiple sources. I'm dealing with different types of data. I'm looking at larger data sets. I'm also looking at more of a real-time kind of a scenario that is there. So these have become the drivers. So what has happened here is why companies as well as organizations, including the government sector, is interested in terms of getting into big data is basically for the reason where they would like to go for predictive analytics as well as the data mining. Now, let us look at some of the interesting questions here. Of course, it might appear as if I'm giving you an example from a movie, but then an interesting question is like this. If you are giving a parole to a criminal, what are the chances that he is going to commit a crime again? Now, if you are looking at the basic data that could help someone in terms of taking a decision, because the question here is, if you are giving a parole, this guy might go out, commit a crime again, and get back. Then there is no point in terms of giving. There's no point in terms of giving a parole to this person. But how do you predict it? Maybe the question here is related to whether big data is going to help me in terms of taking decisions in these kinds of scenarios. Interestingly, when you're looking at the hospital scenarios, of course, I would not like to talk about the current COVID era, but interestingly, when you look at hospital scenarios, if a patient is discharged, what are the chances that within a week, the patient is going to get readmitted?
You know, sir, sorry for interruption.
Yeah.
Sir, again, some audio problem is there, sir. Please check, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, it's okay.
Okay. Is it okay, sir?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
There's some continuous beep noise is there, sir, then and there. We will see, sir. You can start, sir.
Okay. Is the noise still coming, sir?
No, it's good now.
Okay, thank you. So let me go, sir, further. Sorry for the disturbance at my end. But then Now let us look at what is happening with respect to this. If I look at a comparative analysis between the traditional data warehouse applications or appliances that are deployed versus that of the big data analytics that is there, when we are looking in terms of the time that could be taken in terms of deriving value from this, maybe the interesting point here is, since big data is more in terms of real-time nature than the traditional data warehousing applications, traditional data warehousing architectures may not be well-suited for the big data application. So the bottleneck is in terms of the technology as well as the technical skills that are there. So when you're talking about the technology, you're talking about new architecture, you're talking about new algorithms, you're talking about new techniques that are needed. But interestingly, you require expertise in this also, because once a technology gets generated, you need to have enough people with enough expertise in that particular area. That's exactly where we are dealing with experts in using new technology and dealing with the big data that is there. So now, how exactly this data gets presented? Because we said that there could be different types of data from different types of sources that are there. So at a very macro level, you can basically look at these data in terms of three different types. One is structured data, the second one is the unstructured data, and the third one is the semi-structured data. Now, I am taking this approach in such a manner that even for a lay person, we can have some level of understanding as to what are the types of the data and what is the difference between these three types of the data. Now, typically speaking, if I can look at a scenario where I have a table, you can think of a table. Again, one example you can take is, you look at your bank statement. Bank statement is very much structured in the sense that you'll have maybe the serial number of the transaction, the date of the transaction, then the nature of the transaction, then it is whether credit or debit. That's it. Very rigid transaction, very rigid kind of a form in the sense that the structure is very rigid. You have very structured data. Here the example is employee ID, employee name, gender, department of the employee, and salary in lakhs, whatever it is there. Now you add as many employees as possible, the structure of the data, very clearly you know that these are the columns that need to be filled for every person that is there. So any data that can be stored, accessed, and processed in the form of a fixed format, that means that even before you enter the data, you have the format very clearly there with you. The format is known very well in advance. We can derive value out of the data. This is exactly where we talk about the structured data. Currently, typical sizes in the range of multiple zettabytes as far as the big data is concerned. But then the best part of this is...
Sir, audio problem, sir.
Hello.
Audible, sir.
It is audible, sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
It is audible only.
Okay, fine, sir. So the format is known well in advance. We can derive value out of the data. So this is where the best part about the data is you have a structured data. At least you know the kind of structure in which you're dealing with the data, like the example that I given here. Now, let us look at the unstructured data that is there. So when you're talking about the unstructured data, in comparison with structured data, it becomes relatively easy for you, because the first thing is, when we are talking about structured data, I said that a structured data is very neatly, just to imagine, structured data is very neatly arranged in terms of rows and columns of data is the structured data. But then unstructured data is not that simple. You cannot display it in the form of neatly organized columns and rows like a relational database, right? You have multiple types of data, images, audio, video, word processing, emails, spreadsheets, whatever is there, they are going to be there. Estimated 80% of the data, according to Gartner, 80% of the enterprise data is going to be unstructured data, It requires more storage. Now, obviously, you can conclude that compared to that of the structured data, unstructured data it is more difficult to manage and protect with the existing legacy solutions. With the existing solutions, whatever are there, it might be difficult in terms of managing the data compared to that of what is known as the structured data. Now, the unstructured data, again, a very easy way of understanding this. You can look at the picture on the slide. You can look at the picture on the slide. Data with unknown form or the structure, apart from being huge, it poses multiple challenges in terms of its processing for deriving the value out of it. Now, a typical example of unstructured data is a heterogeneous data source containing a combination of simple text files, images, videos, etc. A raw form or unstructured format, they are going to create complexity, especially when it comes to processing the data. Now comes the cross between the structured data as well as the unstructured data. The cross comes here, where we are talking about semi-structured data. Maybe a part of it is structured, a part of it is unstructured. What exactly does it mean? We can see semi-structured data as a structure in form, but it is actually not defined like the table definition in a relational database management systems. We can have examples of semi-structured data as represented in your XML file that is there. You can look at an example like this. Maybe is it structured to a certain extent? Okay, the structure is there. But is it neatly arranged in the form of rows and columns? No, it is not there, neatly arranged in the form of rows and columns. So it is partially structured. That's exactly where the semi-structured data comes into the picture. Now, the idea here is we need to deal with the semi-structured data also in this particular context. Just to look at summarizing the discussion related to the unstructured data, semi-structured data, and the structured data, you can make a comparison. The first part is related to some kind of a data which is written, maybe in a PDF file or some other place, which is completely unstructured. Then comes the semi-structured data, then comes the structured data. In fact, you can see that if you look at this data, more or less the content is related. The content is related to some five students who are there, but at the same time, the format in which the data has been presented is different. Which is a very beautiful way of representing the unstructured data, semi-structured data, as well as the structured data. But remember, when you're dealing with these types of data, you have to deal with all the three types. There is no one size all fits kind of a solution. You need to deal with them. Now, having said this, what we are going to do now is, we are going to basically now take our discussion a little bit further in terms of looking at the technologies that are involved when it comes to dealing with the big data. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Fine, sir.
Suddenly, I saw some phone.
No. Fine, sir.
Right, thank you. So, when we are talking about now the technology part related to big data, remember, what we are going to see in the next few minutes is related to a very gentle introduction to Hadoop without going much into the technology part, but understanding the way in which the Hadoop architecture will help us in terms of dealing with the big data, because the experts related to technology, maybe from tomorrow onwards, they are going to deal with the architecture tools and techniques that are there. So let us look at the kind of, because repeatedly right from the start, I have been telling you that maybe it is difficult for us to deal with the big data by actually utilizing the legacy systems that are there. So in that context, I felt that it is also pertinent for me to deal with a gentle introduction to the technology, especially let me look at the basic Hadoop kind of a framework that is available for us. So let us take a little peep into what Hadoop does here. So when I'm getting into Hadoop, what we understand here is that Hadoop is basically built on Google's MapReduce and Google File System. So let me tell you the philosophy involved in terms of a Google File System as well as Google's MapReduce. If you look at the way in which Google operates, Google typically, right from its start, it was not deploying expensive mainframes, but rather it is using commodity servers that are there and using its own what you call programming in order to basically store the data as well as process the data. So if you look at the story behind the Hadoop, Hadoop is a well adopted standards based. The best part for us is open source software. I believe all of us know that when we are dealing with open source software, basically we can think of it as like a free software where we need not pay. So it is built on the foundation of Google's MapReduce and Google file system. So what does it actually mean? We'll take a few step-by-step approach, small steps we'll take in terms of understanding this. So what does it mean? First part is, when we are looking at the Hadoop platform, it is meant to leverage the power of massive parallel processing. So the first part is, since we are dealing with the huge data, now we are talking about, we are basically looking at leveraging the power of massive parallel processing to take advantage of big data, generally by using lots of inexpensive commodity servers. As I told you, here we are not directly buying a supercomputer to basically deal with the big data, but rather commodity servers. In fact, if you look at the standalone computers which are networked in a lab also, we can create the nodes from them. So what is the basic point here? We can use parallel processing, but then of course it requires standards, it requires certain protocols. So Hadoop is designed basically to take away much of the complexity of the distributed processing. So the moment we are talking about this parallel processing, the question is related to the distributed processing. So people who are actually deploying Hadoop, they need not, developers need not develop on the complexity of the distributed processing. Rather than they can focus on the task at hand, instead of getting lost in the technical details of deploying such a functionality rich environment. How is this possible? Let's see this. Now, as said, the Apache Foundation later, right? What they have done is, they went with the open source framework written in Java that allows distributed processing of large data sets across clusters of computers using simple programming models. So what we are doing right now is, let us try to understand this. We are looking at an open source framework written in Java that allows distributed processing of large data sets. So we are saying that we are dealing with large data sets, right? Say for example, we are dealing with the data that is extracted from the user profiles as well as their interactions from Facebook. Now this is going to be huge data, because on Facebook someone could post a video, someone could just say a like, someone could write something, someone can put a what you call a photo, someone can put a picture, or someone can write something. So what happens here? Basically, we are looking at this. These large data sets, what is it we are doing? Across clusters of computers, right? So we are basically forming the clusters of computers using simple programming models. So a Hadoop framework application works in an environment that provides distributed storage and computation. So interesting perspective here is, from a layman's perspective, if we have to understand this, we are looking at distributed storage and computation. Please look at this. Distributed storage as well as computation across clusters of computers. So here, we are not looking at a single mainframe computer, but rather we are looking at across the clusters of computers that could be doing the job for us. Hadoop is designed to scale up from a single server to thousands of machines, each offering local computation and storage. The best part is the scaling up ability. See, you can move up, you can ramp up from a single server to thousands of machines, each offering local computation as well as storage facilities that are there. Now, taking it a little bit further, now let us look at the other part here, which is known as, the distributed file system. Second one is basically related to what is termed as the map reduce that is there. So if you basically look at the other part of this data that is there, Hadoop map reduce is basically a software framework for easily writing applications. So basically we are here looking at writing applications for processing big amounts of data in parallel on large clusters. Right, thousands of nodes of commodity hardware in a reliable, fault-tolerant manner. Now you see this. The questions that are related to, one is reliability, second one is related to fault tolerance. Both are being taken care here. So in this map reduce, what is the first task is map. This is the first task which takes input data, converts it into a set of data where individual elements are broken down into tuples, your key and the value pairs that are there, just like you can understand the tuple from your RDBMS perspective, where you are looking at that maybe a pair of a key as well as a value for that. Now, this is map part of it, where you are breaking the individual elements into tuples, right? The reduce task takes the output from a map task as the input is as the input and combines those data tuples into smaller set of tuples. The reduce task is always performed after the map task. So what is happening here is, typically both the input and the output are stored in the file system. The framework takes care of scheduling tasks, monitoring them, and then if any failed tasks are there, it is going to basically look at re-executing them. So at a very from a very simple perspective, if you are trying to understand the basic architecture of Hadoop, one part is related to HDFS, that is Hadoop Distributed File System, HDFS, basically the distributed file system. The other part is related to map reduce that is there. So basically, whenever you are looking at the map reduce, it is related to the data processing, which allows parallel and distributed processing that is there. Now, going further in terms of understanding these two, because from a very simple perspective, we are talking about the HDFS as one part and then the map reduce as the other part. Now, looking at the distributed file system, now we are saying that the distributed file system takes care of the storage part. At a very simple level, the HDFS takes care of the storage part. So how does it store the data? The Hadoop HDFS, it breaks the files into smaller pieces of data known as blocks. Of course, the default block size for the HDFS is 128 MB. We can configure the size of the block as per the requirements. These blocks are stored in the cluster in a distributed manner on different nodes. Now it is like this. Normally, when a large task is there, you can break it down into several smaller tasks and then individually do them and then finally combine them, at least at a conceptual level. So taking that particular perspective, what we are saying is, we are looking at breaking down the data into blocks of 128 MB. Then based on your requirements, you can keep on adding or reducing. Then these blocks are stored in a cluster in a distributed manner on different nodes. So that's where you can basically look in the picture where you have data nodes 1, 2, and 3. And there is also a scenario where there is a provision of mechanism for map reduce to process the data in parallel in the cluster that is there. Now, what are the advantages of distributed file system, Hadoop distributed file system? Fault tolerance. Each data blocks are replicated thrice. Now, this where you can also look in terms of the effort that goes behind. Everything is stored on 3 machines, maybe the data nodes by default in the cluster. This helps to protect the data against the data node or the machine failure that is there. Now, when it comes to the space, just add more data nodes if you are going to need more disk space. Now, scalability, that's where we are looking at ramping up the scale of operations, the scale of storage, the scale of processing. Unlike traditional databases, HDFS is highly scalable. It can store and distribute very large data sets across many nodes that can operate in parallel. Now, coming to the flexibility, it can store any kind of data, whether it is structured, semi-structured, or unstructured. A few minutes back, we have seen the differences between the structured data, semi-structured data, as well as the unstructured data. So that's exactly where the ability to handle the different types of data, the flexibility is taken care of. And of course, finally, we are saying that maybe it is also economical, cost-effective. HDFS has direct attached storage, shares the cost of the network and computers it runs on with the MapReduce. It is also an open source software. Now, one example here, before we actually conclude, to understand really in terms of whether whatever we talked about so far in terms of maybe map reduce, then talking about HDFS, then talking about the different types of data, and finally looking at its deployment, whether it works or not, whether this is too technical, I have a small case from the perspective of the application related to Netflix. Now, all of you know that Netflix offers watching of either TV shows or programs or even movies by installing the Netflix app in your TV, or you can do it on your computer also. So we have an interesting scenario that is related to how Netflix actually does business without compromising on the user experience, right? So interestingly, there were also scenarios where Netflix could understand better what kind of customers it is serving. So it was actually able to engage the customers by giving them superior experience. In many cases, whenever we are dealing with business, people believe that you need to reduce the prices in order to get the profits or in order to attract the customers, which need not always be correct. That could be one of the scenarios when it comes to reducing the price of the products or price of the what you call movie watching packages, whatever are there. But then what matters more is in terms of how do you basically enhance the customer experience or the user experience. So interesting perspective here is we are looking at a company that has around 148 million subscribers. Now, of course, it is very it's a very good news when you're talking about 148 million subscribers from the marketing perspective. But then how do you deal with the data of this 148 million people? Because each individual is different from the other individual, right? So what it has done is it started collecting the data related to maybe the date on which the content was watched, the device on which the content was watched. Are you watching the content on a television? Are you watching the content on your smartphone? Are you watching the content on your maybe computer? They are, because this data easily can be collected at the back end. The moment someone logs in into the Netflix app, automatically the server keeps on logging the data that is there. Now there is an interesting question. How the nature of the content watched varied based on the device. Now, just looking at the device alone is different, but then asking an interesting question in terms of the user is the same, but then whenever the device is changing, the nature of the content, is it changing or not? That's an interesting scenario. What kind of searches people are making on the platform? Interestingly, that's where if you look at even our search engine giant like Google also, what kind of searches are being made on the platform? Does it reveal something about the customers? But then you are having millions of subscribers, millions of customers who are doing this. So you're looking at getting the searches on the platform. Now you please look at this. So far, this data seems to be okay. Portions of the content that got rewatched, interesting scenario. When someone is watching a movie, of course, since you are watching it on an app, the kind of question that you are asking is, are you basically looking at the content that gets rewatched, right? Whether the content was paused. Now, all these sometimes look like silly questions, but then this will give a wealth of information from the service provider's perspective. User location data, time of the day, week in which the content was watched, and how it influences the kind of content watched, and metadata from the other parties like Nielsen's and others, because these people conduct lots of surveys. If you look at Nielsen survey ratings that are there, and added to this, if you have the data of your subscribers from the social media websites like Facebook as well as Twitter, now you're going to have a wealth of information. From a business perspective, you're sitting on a gold mine of information. Only thing is you need to mine this data to understand better about your customers. The moment you are able to better understand your customers, in fact, there is also one more case study related to how when you look at these two companies like Amazon as well as Netflix, when they tried to come up with their programming, in one scenario, what happened is Netflix scored over Amazon Prime because they were able to better understand the customers. And they were able to come up with a program called as House of Cards, which was a runaway success because they were able to better understand the kind of content the viewers were actually expecting from Netflix. So Netflix focuses on giving each user what the user wants through a personalized content ranker. Now, please look at this. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Can I continue, sir?
Continue, sir.
Yeah. So Netflix focuses on giving each user what the user wants through a personalized content ranker. Now let us look at this. if I am looking at viewership, how many of the viewers like horror movies? How many of them like adventure movies? How many of them like comedies? How many of them like family dramas? Maybe do they go by the director? Do they go by the hero or the heroine? Now, this is an amazing scenario. If you really look at getting the data, in this particular case, getting the data is okay because your server generates a lot of data, but then mining this data, basically working on this data, and then deriving analytics from it, that is going to be a very big challenging task. But then when Netflix has actually invested in this, they are able to go with what is called as a personalized content ranker that organizes each Netflix user's collection based on personal information collected about the user. Now you have the viewer, the kind of movies, the kind of content that is watched by the viewer. You have got the demographics of the user. You know the age, you know the gender, you know the occupation. Added to this, you have the social networking profile of the user also. You know the patterns of the usage from the perspective of the user. You know which day of the month or maybe which day of the week, what time the user might be preferring, what kind of a content. So Netflix ranks top and trending content, not only based on how popular the content is, but also based on personal information available about the user. The content is promoted on the basis of user's Netflix activity. Now, this is exactly what we call in marketing as personalization or customization. See, I can take a runaway movie and recommend it to everyone. Say, for example, someone is looking at a movie like Bahubali, because Bahubali is a runaway success, you recommend Bahubali to everyone, but there is nothing great in that. But then the other case is, if you are able to understand the kind of preferences each individual customer has got, and you are able to make a recommendation based on which you are catering to the individual requirements. Of course, since we are talking about Netflix, we are talking about the movie business. It could be the same across any of the other sectors also, right? The content is promoted on the basis of the user's Netflix activity. Recently viewed content is sorted based on the analysis of whether users are expected to continue watching or rewatching, or whether users stopped watching due to not finding the content interesting. Netflix doesn't bore its users. See, another problem here is sometimes I think that I am doing a really great job. Maybe last half an hour, last one hour I have been lecturing. I think that I am actually doing a great job, but in reality, I might be actually boring you. Now, this is exactly where Netflix doesn't bore its users. Of course, you can kill a person with boring also if you can show them the boring content also. Quite interesting from the perspective of Netflix. But then Netflix is just a case that I have taken so that our interest, or we can more closely relate to what happens when big data gets deployed. But then at the same time, when you are looking at the other big data applications, you have media and entertainment, which I have already covered. Healthcare we touched upon. Lots of immense potential is there as far as healthcare is concerned. In fact, people talk about combining big data and artificial intelligence that could work wonders as far as healthcare is concerned. Then we talk about the industry verticals related to energy and utilities. In fact, most of these distribution companies, power distribution companies, they have lots of data. Only thing is they're basically looking in terms of getting meaningful data so that they better understand the consumption patterns of their customers, segment them properly, come up with plans that would cater to the individual needs. Next comes your manufacturing. This manufacturing could be related to right from automobiles to spacecrafts also. But then if you can better deploy the data that is already existing with the organizations and then map it along with the consumer demographics, you can work wonders with the data. Education, the less I say, the better, because when we look at education, most of the data sits idle. We collect a lot of data from the students when they take admissions. What happens to this data, no one really knows. One simple interesting phenomenon is, can you predict the dropout rates based on the data that is available with you? So that when the new academic session starts and admissions are over, when you're first class, in your first class itself, you can identify the number of dropouts, who could be the potential dropouts from the course, and start taking interventional action so that dropout phenomenon can be contained. Transportation, huge, tremendous opportunities in terms of looking at. A simple case is today, all of us know about the dynamic pricing that is there when we call a taxi. If you call a Uber or a Ola, what they do is in real time, they will basically have models and algorithms that are going to crunch the data, looking at the supply as well as the demand. Then they go with a dynamic pricing model. Earlier, maybe if you go around 10 years back or 15 years back, airlines were doing it. But today, it need not be only airlines. Anyone, basically in terms of looking at optimization, because you have a platform based on which you can collect both the demand as well as the supply. Insurance, huge opportunity. When you look at the kind of potential that exists in terms of the demographic information that is made available, and then added to this, if you have the socioeconomic status, of course, it also could be a part of the demographics. There is immense potential in terms of the deployment of the big data. And of course, I did not mention here, but most of the governments across the globe, they may not directly say, but they already deal with the big data, because most of our data sits on the servers of the government. It could be any kind of a government, whether it is a monarchy, whether it is a democracy, including democracies, governments collect a lot of data. Simple case is today you look at Aadhaar data that is there with the government. Added to this, your tax profiling, right? Because your PAN card is linked with Aadhaar data. Now it is almost like you are nude as far as the government is concerned. Government knows everything about you because your bank accounts are linked with Aadhaar as well as your bank account at least is linked with your PAN, but your PAN is linked with Aadhaar. That's it, over. Everything is there with the government. Interesting scenarios. But then, just to look at the concluding part of it, what I can say at this point of time, is basically we are looking at the scenario that is related to the role that is played by the big data. So in the future, big data is bound to play a bigger role in the future as all of us become more digital. The reason why I'm talking about digital is maybe earlier also there could be scenarios where data could have been produced, but it is as simple as this. The more we get into digital transactions, the more data that we are going to generate, the more data that we are generating, the more data we are also consuming. At the end of the day, all of us become contributors as well as consumers of the big data. Of course, what we are considering as big data today, will it remain as big data in the future? Need not be. Because over a period of time, the technological developments, they may lead to new frameworks. Maybe who thought that today we are dealing with computers. We are dealing with computers that have gigabytes of RAM with them. A 16 GB gigabyte RAM personal computer was unheard 15 years back. So interesting perspective here is what is considered as big data today may not remain as big data at a later point of time. And as I said, almost every sector, it could be corporate sector, it could be government, it could be non-profit sector, everyone would eventually deploy big data analytics to enhance their performance. So this is where I would like to basically conclude my discussion related to the introduction to big data. Now the house is open for questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your valuable session. I request the participants who are want to ask a question, please raise your hand so that I can unmute you so that we can have a discussion with our sir, Srinivas sir. So, Jeevita V. Madam, Jeevita, madam. Hima Bindu.
Hello.
Yes, madam. Hearing, madam. Please.
I am Hima Bindu from Pada College of Engineering and Technology.
Madam.
Sir, is there any research area towards big data analytics?
Yeah, many research areas are there, madam. But the did you complete your question, madam?
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, but then the question is, would you like to do research from the technological perspective or from the application perspective? That is what you need to be clear at.
Oh, technology perspective.
Okay, technology perspective, if you really look in terms of the topics that are there, one is looking at the frameworks that are available, and okay. then the kind of technologies and their efficacies you can look at.
Okay, thank you. Right. Thank you very much, sir.
So next, IV Srinivas Reddy, sir. Sir, IV Srinivas Reddy,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, yeah, please.
No, no, sir. I am asking about the participant. IV Srinivas Reddy, sir, available? So, Jeevita V. Jeevita, madam? No. Sri Prasad. Sir, Siva Prasad. Sir, Siva Prasad, sir, you raised your hand. Shravani.
Hello, sir.
Yes, madam.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, actually, I'm from engineering domain, sir. Hello.
Ma'am, your voice is somewhat, madam, some disturbance is there.
Okay, sir. Sir, I'm from actually electrical domain, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, I'm seeing the papers regarding big data analytics in smart grid, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
So, I was in a dilemma that which tools I need to use for big data analytics in smart grid. So as soon as I have seen this, I have selected this FDP. So is it useful for me?
Definitely, madam. As you go further, yeah. maybe yeah. from tomorrow onwards, the discussion becomes more intense in terms of the tools and techniques.
Okay.
Today part yeah. is only a curtain raiser. So definitely, if you are looking from the power sector, huge opportunities there. In fact, lots of power companies also, they are trying to find out the base in which they can better deploy the big data analytics. So opportunity is there, madam.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Next, Paul Sheba. Madam?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Yes, ma'am. Sarah is there.
Good evening, sir. Actually, I have a doubt on the role of data scientist and data analyst.
So, okay.
If I wanted to be a data analyst or data scientist, what difference makes or what software I have to possess?
Okay.
How I can guide my students on this?
Okay. Madam, if you look at these terms in terms of data scientist, data analyst, and then data engineer, right?
Yeah.
One is, if you look at the entire analytics domain itself, we okay. basically look at it as an intersection of three areas.
Okay.
One is related to the basic grounding in mathematics and statistics.
Okay.
Mathematics and statistics. That part is there, madam. Second part is related to your ability to deploy the computer science. Because if you have to use these methods, you cannot manually do this. You need to basically go with the deployment of your computer science, both in terms of software and hardware. That's the second part. Third part is your domain expertise. So if you are looking more in terms of a data scientist, first thing is there is no compromise as far as your math and stat expertise is concerned, because that's where your bread and butter is there. But then in order to deploy it, you need to have at least a good hold on one language like R or Python in the current scenario. But if you are looking at more in terms of an analyst, right? You need to have expertise in the domain area, because you are looking at making an analyst as a career. Domain area plus maybe your ability to understand the stats and then deploy them using any of the languages.
As a computer science student, I can suggest them to go with...
See, computer science students, more in terms of data engineering, they are more suitable. Our discussion with the industry, it revealed that, say, for example, a commerce student will have that expertise in the area of commerce, plus maybe he can learn a little bit of math and stat, plus a language also. Mm-hmm. But he may not be very good at the data architecture and other areas that are there.
Okay.
So there also issues are there. So what happens is, by the very virtue of studying computer science, you are more grounded for a data engineer But that doesn't mean that if the student has got the aptitude, say for example, a computer science student who has got enough aptitude in terms of getting into analytics, mass and stat is there, you can encourage them to get into this area also. Not at all an issue.
Okay. And what about artificial intelligence?
See, artificial intelligence is more advanced in terms of you trying to make machines behave like human beings.
Okay.
Right, madam?
Yes.
So if you look at the earlier roles of data scientists and other things, we go up to the maximum level of machine learning.
Okay.
They can have some level of deployment related to neural networks and other things, but they may not be having the complete expertise in terms of designing self-driving cars or something else, because that is the core of artificial intelligence.
Okay.
So if you look at this, in fact, even if you look at these scenarios, lots of overlap across these areas. But yeah. AI, if you really ask me, if I am looking at a data scientist, he may not be an expert in artificial intelligence, but he might be very good at machine learning, which could be considered as a subset of artificial intelligence.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
The next, Raviga.
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Sir, in some of this slide, first of all, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, one of the slide you are saying that the data will be duplicated in all the different machines, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that an advantage or a disadvantage? Because in my perspective, I think it will become a disadvantage.
Okay, let me just tell you, sir. Look at the stock exchange data,
okay.
Right? Now, what happens if Bombay Stock Exchange server crashes?
Okay.
Okay, by default, without talking about even big data also, they will have a backup somewhere in Bangalore or where you will be having the replication that is done. In fact, on one day it was reported that when they found a problem in terms of starting the server at Bombay, they started the server at Bangalore. No one even knows that the Bangalore server is working. So what is happening here is basically we are trying to pay a premium to basically take care of that failure occurring.
Okay.
Right? That's the only idea behind that. Maybe tomorrow, if you are having even a better kind of a scenario that is there, right, things might improve. But as of now, at the very basic level, I am talking about this Apache Hadoop kind of a setup. These types of innovations are there.
Okay. So it is to just overcome the as you told, it's for fault tolerant. Am I right?
Yeah, right.
Sir, hello.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, one more question, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, HDFS, right? So Hadoop,
right.
Distributed File System.
Right.
So here, what we until I know, what we're doing is we are distributing this data into different systems.
Right.
Am I right?
Right.
Is it that we are distributing the data or we are keeping the copy of the total data in different systems?
See, we are distributing as well as you are having copies also.
Achcha, okay.
Because
okay.
We said that apart from distribution, you are also having the copies, no?
Okay. So we are map reducing them and getting the result, right?
Sir.
Oh, fine, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, Anandan Palanivel, sir, you can ask.
Yes, sir, I am working in agriculture point of view, sir.
Please, sir.
Hello?
Yeah, please.
I have the working in the meteorology. I have collected the data of 40 years data.
Okay.
Okay, I have no knowledge about big data. How old am I entering? What are the things I have to learn basically?
See, basically, once you complete this webinar, sir, all these next 5 days, sir. Right,
okay,
you'll have a basic idea in terms of where to start with in terms of learning the big data, because tomorrow onwards they'll be talking about the tools and technologies that are there, right?
Okay,
once you catch up in terms of finding out what are the various avenues that are there, right? You can at least look at one roadmap for the data that is available with you and stick to it, sir.
Definitely.
Right?
Thank you, sir. Right.
Srinivas Reddy, sir, you can ask your doubt. Yes, Ram Karthik, you can ask your doubt.
Sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, actually, I just have one doubt, sir. We just have data analytics. And these data, mainly these data analytics, these are done by means of various programming languages, R programming languages, Python. So which one is the best one, sir? I just want to thorough with, if I want to do any data analytics, if I want to sort my career in data analytics, so do I have to be first professional with Python or R, then only I can proceed with this analytics career?
Okay.
Or that's what I'm asking, sir. So I have to be thorough with that one. And any mathematical background I need to proceed with this career option, that's what.
Sir, to answer your question, having a good hold on mathematics and statistics is a must, sir. If you are getting into analytics, the basic thing is that you need to be good at both mathematics and statistics. Now, the second part is, especially for beginners, you need to be good at least one language. Now, if you had asked me this question in 2016 or 17, maybe people would have closed their eyes, and even I would have closed my eyes and said, go and learn R. Today the scenario is different. Today the scenario is different.
Uh-huh.
What happened is, this R and Python are going neck and neck. Both are open source only. So if you have time, learn both.
Okay.
But if you don't have time, my personal advice, looking at the trends that are there, is go for Python. Because
Python, that's best. Okay,
Python, they say, has got lots of brute force power in terms of web scraping and other things.
Built-in functions, packages, yeah. Everything.
So I came across an article that compared R and Python with that of Batman and Superman.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so that is the kind of scenario that I'm talking about, right? So at this given point of time, you can invest your time, you can learn both. Otherwise, if you have limitations in time, of course, I am not a very great expert in Python, but Python is a safe bet. To that extent, I can tell you, because most of my business analytics students, they made their careers by being good at Python.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Shankar, sir, you can ask your doubt. Shankar, sir.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. My name is Shankar. I'm working as a assistant professor. I'm new in this data science field.
Sir.
I could say, big data. I wanted to work with this big data for agriculture field.
Sir.
So where I could learn thoroughly from scratch to go ahead with research in this big data and agriculture parallelly.
Okay, sir. Agriculture part, you have to excuse me, sir, because I'm not an expert in that area, in the sense I'm not an expert in big data also, but I can suggest you. Because if you're looking at agriculture, you can consult someone from an agricultural university, right? Because they might be actually looking at what kind of data inputs might be there. That's where, but I know that a lot of computer science professors in Hyderabad University, they also work on the agriculture area. because they have lots of projects related to that. So work is being done in that particular area, no doubt about that. But then when it comes to getting into big data, you need to be clear. Are you basically looking at a career in big data? Are you trying to look at doing some research in the area of agriculture by using big data? So if that is the case, the next part is related to, would you like to go with an online platform? Because there are n number of online platforms that are available today where you can reasonably, I'm not saying that you could become a total expert, but a reasonably good expertise could be developed in the areas of these languages. Say, for example, if you look at right from Analytics Vidya, the Indian portal, or you can look at Data Camp, right? You have multiple sources, or Great Lakes Institute is there. They do have good programs, considered to be at least the number one, institute as far as this data analytics is concerned. So if you look at this kind of a scenario, I can suggest you that you can choose from any of these available based on your convenience, right? So then it all depends in terms of your perseverance. But the biggest problem with the online programs is you need to be self-motivated. Okay, most of the people, they enroll in online courses, but then they will drop out. That's a major problem with online courses. The number of people who complete the online courses is very low. Yeah.
You know, tell any good platform from where I can learn from scratch.
Sir, maybe it you can refer to the web, because I might end up promoting courses or platforms that are there. Or another good idea is you wait till all the experts teach you, then you can take a call. Because I can take a few sites' name, but I don't think whether it might be a good idea in terms of naming those sites and telling you to enroll in them. Right? Don't worry about that. You will you can make out very easily. Huh?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Next, Yusupu C.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I'm from St. Martin's Engineering College.
Sir.
Today, every day, data is being generated.
Sir.
If the data is distributed imbalanced, it leads to the inefficient parallel execution.
Right,
which is the best algorithm to overcome this problem, sir?
Okay. Tools part, really, I'm not focusing today, sir. Right? So that my friend Suresh will be dealing with.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Kandalpat Suresh will be dealing with. Because I really is tools part is not my area of expertise, right?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Next, Rajesh Kandan. Rajesh Kandan.
No. I believe my answer is evoking some kind of a laughter, but let me be very clear. When I have accepted this, from the perspective of the deployment of big data, I agreed for an introduction to big data. That's what I'm saying. I cannot go into an area where I do not have expertise. This might evoke some laughter from the participants, but I believe that, this is a way where I have given a sincere answer, rather than saying something that I don't know.
Yes, sir. So next, Dr. N.V. Ramanamurthy.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, the way you explained the things is extremely good, sir. I'm very happy for that. Sir, as a computer science engineer, I know that because you have discussed something around, something about sentiment analysis.
Right. Yeah, please.
Right, sir. As a computer science engineer, I know that sentiment analysis is used for classification of emotions, like positive, negative, neutral, kind of.
Perfect.
But I came to know that recently in business also, the business people are using this sentiment analysis for to identify the customer sentiment.
Yes, sir.
Towards selling their products and brands.
Perfect, sir.
I want to know some small details about it. How they're, what is the tactics behind it?
Okay. See, sir, basically, maybe compared to the previous question, I like this because my fundamental area is marketing. So we look at how our brand is performing in the market, sir. One of the biggest challenges for us is how was the tendency of the customers as far as my brand is concerned. Now, interesting thing is, today, maybe this is applicable to a particular brand in terms of how people are discussing about the brand. Now, what happens here is the moment I am able to better know the emotions, I try to intervene. Second thing is I don't know anything about how my brand is being evaluated. So what happens here is even political figures, if you especially see in the American context, they continuously monitor this and then they try to intervene. Similarly here, when we are looking at the brands that are there, online basically we look at the chatter that is going on as far as the brand is concerned. Because in certain cases, what happens is at the end of the day, the brand matters more than the product. See, really speaking, Coke and Pepsi, if I empty it into a glass, can people really differentiate between Coke and Pepsi? No one knows. But then the brand matters. Brand actually has got the value.
Yes, sir.
So what happens is we actually look at going through the polarity of the brand. Are people talking positively about the brand? Are they talking negatively? Or are they neutral about the brand? I'll give you a small example, sir. You take Maggi noodles.
Okay.
Some 4 or 5 years back, what happened is people said that there is a lot of monosodium glutamate in the Maggi noodles. So
yes,
it is really bad
propaganda has come.
Now you see those fellows today, no one even remembers it.
Oh, no. Yes.
So very structurally they do it, especially Nestle is a multinational company. They said that before even talking about noodles, they said that we are into this milk products for babies, we are into chocolates, we are this. And over a period of time, slowly what happened is the entire content they gave in such a manner that the negative attitude towards the brand has been overcome.
Yes, yes.
Sir.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your query.
Thank you.
Next, Anuradha Sharma. Next, Dr. N.V. Ramanamurthy. Triveni V. They are not unmuting. Naga Ramana Devi.
Sir, good evening, sir. This is Naga Ramana Devi.
Good evening.
Hello. Sir, my question is, you have already spoke about the different types of data volumes. You said that 4 types of data volumes. I heard about this, somebody saying 3 volumes or somebody saying 5. Exactly how many volumes you are going to be handling?
As many V's as people would like to have, madam. Because what happened is, people initially started with, without veracity, they were talking about volume, velocity, right? And the other V. Then what happened over a period of time, people said that no, veracity. Then someone said that we would like to add value also. So these are just only the keywords that we need to remember in terms of understanding the characteristics of big data, right? So people can keep on going, adding Vs or decreasing Vs also. But then the whole idea here is, can I understand big data from the perspective of the framework given by the IBM scientists?
Okay.
Right? So that's exactly where this volume, velocity, variety and veracity came into the picture, so that we understand that this data is going to be a bit different from the earlier data warehouses or the databases that we have dealt with, because there the data was more structured and a rigid format is there, but whereas this data is going to be handled in a different manner. Just to understand that the 4 P's kind of a framework is there, madam.
Sir, could you please tell me the exact difference between map and reduce? What you are doing in map, what you are doing in reduce?
Okay, let me just give you here, madam, the idea that is there. If I am looking at the 2 parts that is there in terms of the map task and reduce task, the first task which takes the input data, converts it into a set of data where individual elements are broken, that part is there. Now this goes as the input to the reduce task. Then the processing is done. Then the output are given to the users.
Sir, you said that. Is there any techniques we are using, sir, in while you are doing of map, while you are doing of reducing?
No, that,
is there any methods you are using?
That part I am not taking, madam. This is as a part of introduction. We are looking at the technology. That's what I am saying. I don't have expertise in that area, but from a common man's perspective, having said so much about big data, how exactly big data gets handled, that's the context in which I look at the Hadoop ecosystem.
Sir, there is a one word, is that commodity. What does it mean of commodity?
Yeah, that's quite interesting, man. So when you're talking about commodity servers, see, commodity servers are like, you have the general machines that are there, unlike actually going and buying a very costly supercomputer kind of a scenario, you take maybe multiple common computers, then you put them in a rack, then you make a commodity server. This is what Google has done.
Okay. Okay. Is there any sizes there, sir, for each and every commodity machines should have this type of...
No. These people, they went up with their own way in terms of the... especially from the search engine perspective, they started with the commodity servers, madam. There is no one particular size to my knowledge.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. Next, Srinivas Reddy.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, what is the difference between data mining applications and big data applications, sir?
Okay. See, data mining, basically, if you have to use it from the context of analytics, right? Your okay. ability to deal with the databases where okay. you are able to find out meaningful patterns. Say, for example, sir, I have lots of customer data. And okay. then say, for example, I am doing some mining so that I am doing some customer segmentation, right, sir?
Okay.
That is the general way of understanding data mining. But then when okay. you're talking about big data applications, you're not dealing with the simple databases, but rather you're dealing with the data that is having all this volume, velocity, variety, blah, 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 whatever it is there. So it is no longer easy for you in terms of dealing with the data similar to the way you have dealt it in data mining.
Okay.
Okay. That's the basic.
Always I am thinking, so both are maybe similar to them.
Sir, you can refer, especially when you're talking about data mining only, that is used in the context of organized databases. See, here also still it could be data mining only, but only thing is, it may not be in the context of databases because the end outcome of data mining is pattern recognition.
Okay, sir.
Right, sir. Here also you can get pattern recognition, but only thing is that was mostly used in the context of databases. Mostly, that's the main difference.
Okay, sir, here we are using use data sets.
Data sets here also, technically speaking, you can use the term called as data mining because larger data sets you are using, but it is not going to be as simple as data mining in the context of databases.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Next is Janardhan Reddy. Sir? Janardhan Reddy, sir?
Hello, sir. Sir, yeah. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Andy.
Sir, I actually want to ask one question, sir.
Sir.
So now we are in a COVID-19 time. That means we are in a lockdown time. So can we suggest by using data analytics, can we suggest any medicine? That means not in the sense by we have a different types of pandemics like cholera, like that. Based upon that, different pandemics, if we are supposed to make a data analysis, can we suggest any solution for this COVID-19, sir?
See, if you are looking at only data analysis, I can suggest you, sir. Lots of data is available on Kaggle. You can go to a data site called as Kaggle. Lots of analysis and data is there. But then, if you're talking about medicine, sir, that requires domain expertise also, sir, in addition to this data. Because just like a data crunching, no?
So here my intention is, can we suggest any solution, sir? That's why in that aspect I ask, sir.
No, we can do, but only thing is, since it is related to basically medicine and human health, that cannot be just based on data crunching. We need to have the support from the medical fraternity also, because what they say is, one is whether this data, whatever is available. I'll tell you a small example, sir. China, they reported around 85,000 cases. Now we are around 95,000 cases. Do you really think that China has got only 85,000 cases? If the data is bad, in the sense that if that data cannot be relayed upon, now if we make the analysis, I'm just giving this as an example, right?
Sir.
Our outcome would be as good as the data that we are taking. That's the only concern. And then added to that, if you are looking at suggesting the medicine, somewhere down the line, we need to take the expertise from the doctors also, sir.
So, okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Kalai Salam sir, respond. Pick up the participants' questions. Kalai sir.
Deepthi Kalwa madam.
Yeah, sir. Dr. Srinivas, sir.
Sir.
Yeah. Sorry for inconvenience, sir. Many participants are asking, but because of time factor.
Participants are there. Sorry.
Yeah, last, we can give a chance for last three candidates, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, because of time is up, sir. Many of the participants will have to attend one more FDP program. Our organizers will have one more program, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah.
So next to Vaishali madam.
Hello.
Yeah madam.
Good evening sir.
Good evening madam.
Sir, your session was very good. Sir, I want to ask you one question. Suppose we want to go with the one particular framework, so can we go for the generalized framework?
Like I didn't get you madam.
Sir, suppose we want to go with the one particular framework like in healthcare.
Okay, okay. You're trying to talk about the vertical, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So can we go for the generalized framework?
My suggestion is, see, it is better to focus on a vertical. Over a period of time, you will develop the expertise. Let me tell you.
Okay.
See, the same question, I'll just give it as an example also.
Okay.
Just now, someone asked me a technical question about Hadoop. I told that is not my expertise. Let me tell you my experience. When I started, I tried to master everything. Then immediately, 2017, when we started MBA in Business Analytics, first thing is from Business Administration, I got into analytics.
Yeah.
Then slowly realized that with the given constraints that are there, you can have a reasonable, good understanding of the different areas, but you can't master everything. Otherwise, what happens is maybe you try to learn too many things or master too many things and finally end up not mastering anything. So that's where you don't make a mistake. You take a vertical which is most relevant for you. Say, for example, my vertical is marketing. My expertise lies in marketing analytics.
Okay.
I do understand big data analytics. We deploy big data for marketing. But yeah. I am not an expert. If someone asks me, where is your expertise? I say, my expertise is in marketing analytics. I understand big data analytics. We look at deploying big data for marketing. But big data technology, sorry, that's not my area. Right? Over a period of time, you need to have expertise in a vertical that is going to help you more. Please remember this.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
This is my personal opinion, madam.
But actually, someone is forcing you to go with the generalized framework. So is it possible in the big data to create a framework which is going to helpful for the generalization? See,
if you can spend enough amount of your time and resources, you can. But then that question you can only answer whether you have the enough amount of time and expertise.
Okay.
Right.
But it is possible to go with the generalized framework.
I doubt, madam. With my experience, I doubt it.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Next, Sri Ramamurthy. Sri Ramamurthy.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Sir, a small doubt, sir, actually.
Yeah.
How you calculate real-time data in Hadoop, sir?
Okay. How do you calculate? I will keep it aside, but I will give you my application part, sir. My application part.
Actually, because... we have several... Pardon?
No. Your tools and applications will come tomorrow, but let me tell you, online I am purchasing something. Okay. Can you give me an offer so that my purchasing increases? That's my question. Real-time application, when I mean to say, compared to data warehouses where you are looking at dealing with historical data, can you go with a real-time application is the kind of scenario that today industry is demanding. That's what I'm saying, sir. And then how do you do it? Your tools and applications will come from tomorrow onwards.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sir, last participant query, sir.
Sir.
Vasumadi Mohan.
Hello, sir.
Hello, madam.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, in
management field, we use the term knowledge management.
Right.
Okay, right. Sir. But nowadays, are you using the knowledge management technique or are you using the data mining techniques?
See, knowledge management is a very broad term, madam. If you really look at it, then when you are looking at this data mining and applications, these are specific from the perspective of analytics, these terms that are being used. Because at the end of the day, that also is a subset of knowledge management. Whatever data mining we are using also results in enhancement of data.
So nowadays, right? They are using data or not, sir?
Still knowledge management, madam. People who are into the area of knowledge management, they are still continuing in the area of knowledge management.
Illa, better, I'm asking a question, sir. Whether to use knowledge management or it is better to use data mining?
Data mining is a technical term, madam. Knowledge management is a broader term that looks at the enhancement of the information.
But this, both are going to collect the data.
No, both will complement each other.
Oh.
Okay.
So whether I can use knowledge management in my software development environment?
Yeah, you can. You can.
Okay. I thought it is an alternative to knowledge management is an alternative to data mining.
Say, madam, if you are doing agriculture, irrigation is a part of agriculture. Irrigation is a part of agriculture. So in knowledge management, if you are looking at your data mining can enhance knowledge management. No doubt about it.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your patience and answering for all the queries. I request our coordinator, sir, Dr. Venkat Rao, sir.
Yes, sir.
Please initiate and we'll complete the session, sir.
Yes, sir. And myself, Professor Venkat Rao from CSC Department, St. Martin's Engineering College. And good evening to you all. And let me first express my sincere thanks to all the participants who are registered for this FDP and showing and has shown in a lot of interest. And I also thank to the today's speaker, Dr. V. Srinivas Kumar Garu, for accepting our invitation and delivering in such a fantastic and illustrative and informative lecture. And thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And I also express my sincere apologies on behalf of the organization committee so one participant made in some comment. So we see that it won't repeat again, sir.
No, it's okay, sir.
And then I would like to express my sincere thanks to our beloved principal, Dr. P. Santosh Kumar Patra, and the Dean Academics, Professor Amarendra Babu, and HOD CIC Department, Dr. Uday Kumar, sir, and HOD IT Department, Dr. Achyut Rao, sir, for continuously supporting us in making this event realize. And also, I am also thankful to the Mr. Chandra Dashaka and Krishna Prasad, members from the CSI Hyderabad chapter, for their support and association to organize this event. And I also thank to the coordinators of this FDP, Dr. S.A. Kalaiselvan, Professor CSC Department, and also Dr. R. Raja, Professor CSC Department, and their team members for making this event in a grand manner. And also, finally, Ms. Neha Nandal for coordinating this entire session and conducting in a wonderful session. So thank you, sir, for each and everyone for making this event grand success. Almost 1,000 participants were participated today. And thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir, thank you, sir. We are having a wonderful session. Your topics are very much interested topic. We have somewhat updated ourselves, our knowledge also get updated. And I requested our Dean Academics, Dr. Amendra Babu, sir, few words.
Thank you, Kalai. I must first thank sir for a wonderful lecture, very knowledgeable lecture. It's a good start.
Thank you, sir.
It is a sort of kick start. Namaste. And definitely another 6 days, you know, good start is always, you know, good finish also. We will definitely going to have a wonderful time in next five days. I think again, once again, I thank him for coming, making his, you know, time available for us, and then giving a well prepared lecture. Thank you, sir. And tomorrow, I think we have to have again a small session, 5 minute session before starting the this thing. So we'll have a meeting sometime before that. Yeah. Okay,
sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And I'm asking my department of CSE, HOD, sir, Dr. Udayar Kumar, sir, please express yourself.
Srinivas Kumar, sir, very excellent, sir. And you handled the session very nicely. And everybody, almost all are very happy. And even you handled that question session also very nicely. Even I think if the question is going on continuously also, you will answer another 2 to 3 hours. Very nice, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And next, I'm requesting our IT department, HOD, sir, to a few words.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Welcome back, sir. First of all, I am very much happy to listen all the session throughout continuously, 5 o'clock to 7:30. I thank you, sir, to accepted our invitation on behalf of our St. Martin's Engineering College management principals and our team. Thank you, Dr. V. Santosh Kumar, Srinivas Kumar, sir. Everyone has given a good feedback, sir.
Thank you.
You are able to answer many, many questions.
Sir, in chat, all are telling very good feedback. Everybody appreciating.
Oh, thank you. Really a good opportunity for us.
And, thank you, sir. And one more thing, I'm regretting inconvenience. We cannot provide much questions on behalf of audience. Next time we will do that next time onwards. And also I thank to you, sir, a good initiation is half of the work is to be done.
Right.
As Amarendra Babu sir said that it is a great kickstart.
Right.
Thank you. I thank to all organizing team, especially Kalai Selvan sir, Raja sir, Venkat Rao sir, Neha Nandal ma'am, and our organizing respected members, and e-publicity team, today the WhatsApp team, coordinators, nicely they have patiently given answers. And I request Dr. Srinivas Kumar, sir, if you provide PPT, we will share to all our WhatsApp groups, sir.
Definitely.
With your permission.
I'll send to you, sir.
Yeah, please.
Yes, everybody
provide,
requesting
sir.
The PPT only in the WhatsApp,
yes,
group.
Sir.
All are asking.
They're also very much happy to see your PPT, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
And finally, I thank our principal, sir, to provide an opportunity, who is a backbone of CSE and IT department, exclusively, constantly motivated from Amarendra Babu, sir, to the last faculty member, teaching and non-teaching staff. Thank you very much, sir, to give an opportunity. Thank you, Kalai, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. The next, our very much important person, Krishna Prasad, sir, and Chandra Dasaka, sir. And I am inviting Krishna Prasad, sir. Sir, any few words, sir?
Looks like he exited, yeah, just now.
Okay, fine, sir. Sir Venkat Rao, sir, you finish this, sir.
What?
Okay, sir, fine, sir. Thank you to all.
Okay,
thank
sir.
You for the participants. For your response.
Thank you.
Thanks
Dr.
to all.
Kumar, sir.
Thank you. Thanks to especially our speaker today. Very patiently answered for all the questions. Thank you very much, sir. We are waiting for the next session with you, sir. Same like that, the next FDP.
Organize a meeting and then give an invite to everybody.
Yes, sir. Right.
Tomorrow.
Yeah. Right, sir. Tomorrow we'll speak later, sir. Right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Kale, sir. You have a nice day, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sir, speaker, sir.
Thank you.
Srinivas, sir. Thank you very much, sir. For your coming for our FDP.
Thank you very much for your wonderful
Yes. Kalai Selvan sir and all other organizing team, they have done a very wonderful job today.
Yes, sir.
And the session ended very nicely.
Yes.
Right.
Yes. I thank you, Neha Nandal madam, to initiate this program. She is the first initiator of this program.
Correct.
Thank you, madam. Neha Nandal madam.
All the team members have done well.
Yes. Thank you.
Good job, madam. Neha Nandal ma'am. Very good job. Good initiative.
Yes. Initiation is important.
Not only Madam, but Kalai sir, excellent. The way of organizing.
Sure.
Go ahead, sir.
I thank the Raja, sir.
I wish you all the best for further successful days.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
And your soulmate, Raja, sir, also.
Sure, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, sir.
Very good. And Babu, sir, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thanks to all, sir. Okay, sir. Let us end the session, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks for the participants. Thank you for all the HOD, team, CEOs, everybody, sir. Yes, Raja, sir.
Excellent, sir. Very nice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
What comment you made?